In the age of information, digital empowerment has driven India's transformation into a knowledge economy. The roadmap was charted 5 years ago under the Digital India Initiative with three key goals: providing infrastructure as a utility for every citizen, enabling governance and services on demand, and digital empowerment of citizens. In 5 years, we have seen the impact of that move, boosting efficiency and investments in business, enabling important e-governance initiatives, and laying the groundwork for financial and social inclusion for the masses. To take stock of where we have arrived in these 5 years of Digital India and where we are headed next, Google and CNBC TV 18 have partnered to bring you a special presentation titled Digital India Vision 5.0. Now, this virtual summit provides an important platform for bringing together top decision makers from the government, captains of industry, and leaders from civil society to exchange ideas and insights that catalyze India's next wave of transformation. I'm your host, Gautam Srinivasan, and I will be taking you through the summit's key events. So let's start with the keynote address on Digital India by Ravi Shankar Prasad, the Union Minister of Communications, Electronics and IT.
Digital India has completed 5 years of its journey. It was a transformative program initiated under the vision of our Prime Minister. We launched it formally in July 2015 after doing all the groundwork, and after close to 6 years, it will be significant to know as to how much change we have been able to usher in. Digital India, simply put, is designed to empower ordinary Indians with the power of technology, bridge the digital divide, and most important, bring in digital inclusion. Digital India is more for those who seek to get empowered. And this has to be achieved by technology which is homegrown, developmental and inclusive. Now it is time to see how change has occurred on the ground. You have seen India's digital profile, close to 1.20 billion mobile phone, nearly 7 million smartphones. You have seen close to 640 billion internet. You have seen 1.26 billion plus Aadhaar digital identity card. How Digital India is operating on the ground? We linked up close to 400 million, 40 crore bank account of the poor, linked with Aadhaar to confirm their digital identity, to supplement the physical identity, and reinforced by the mobile. And we started sending welfare measures directly to the bank account of the poor, which we call DBT, direct benefit transfer. And we sent close to 11 lakh crore, more than $123 billion, into the bank account of the poor in 439 schemes, Government of India and the state government. And we saved 1,70,000 crore approximately, close to $22 billion plus, which is to be pocketed by middlemen and fictitious claimants. So Digital India is promoting good governance and also development. Programs like e-hospital, e-scholarship, e-visa, e-kisan, all are very transformative in nature, whose benefits people are realizing. Digital skilling, digital literacy. And today, Digital India has become a developmental program being accepted by the entire country, and our theme of inclusion being talked about globally. That is very important. In the COVID, you have seen we have used technology in a very extraordinary way. You have seen Arogya Setu, nearly 14 crore people using it. Simple technology with due regard to privacy for a limited period to help you contact tracing in the event you come in contact with someone inflicted or affected, as the case may be. In the case of COVID Savdhan, COVID messaging, we have sent crores of message in a targeted manner to address the concerns of people in quarantine. Work from home, I liberalized the entire regime, security, etc. And I have personally, in a very proactive manner, extended it till the end of this month. 85% of India's work from home is happening. I'm very happy that when we took some tough measures against certain apps on the ground of national security, on the grounds of securing the privacy of Indian data, of Indians, including exercising our sovereign power in pursuit of safety and security of India. The Prime Minister appealed that Indians create apps, and today 7,000 individuals and corporate Indians have applied in that competitive system, and we are going to pick up the best. And the eligibility was app must be in use for some time. About 2,000 entities have come for video conferencing facility. India's startup movement is doing very well and become third biggest in the world. Therefore, you have seen that today, digital governance through Digital India is encompassing all walks of life. It is promoting delivery. It is promoting good governance. It is promoting innovation. And most important is promoting empowerment. Today, Aadhaar is being talked about globally as well. And again, homegrown technology developed by Indians as to how the digital identity can be reinforced to help discover correct physical identity. We have also pushed electronic manufacturing in a very, very big way. From Meritu Mobile Factory, India is home to nearly 260 mobile factories. And we recently we have launched the production link incentive, inviting the global technological company to come to India in mobile manufacturing, component manufacturing, and also five national champions Indian companies. This particular scheme, even during these challenging times, received extraordinary response. And on 31st of July, when the last day of the application ended, all the top mobile manufacturers, contract manufacturers have come to India. And they have committed to make mobile phone and components worth 11.5 lakh crore in the coming 5 years, with export potential of 7 lakh crores and giving job to 12 lakh Indians, 3 lakh direct, and about 9 lakh indirect. Therefore, even the electronic manufacturing system is working quite well. We are pushing the case of medical electronics also. India should become a big hub for that. The point to note is that all the policy initiatives we have put in place, namely software product policy, electronic policy, communication policy, and your open source policy. As far as data is concerned, we are very clear, we will not be compromising on the data sovereignty of India and Indians. We shall not tolerate any data imperialism. We understand the value of data. And therefore, the data protection law is subject to parliamentary scrutiny. Just to concretize, individual data will be taken only with the consent by the data company which shall take it, whom we have called data fiduciary. That consent must be explicit and must be for a specified purpose. There is a provision of data protection authority. And other provisions are there, including penalty in the event you transgress those limitations. In the case of transmission of data, we have said super sensitive data cannot go out of India. Sensitive can go but with consent of the individual or community, and non-personal can go. Our view is very clear. Data is an important resource, and I want India to become a big center of data cleaning, data innovation, and data commerce. That's our case as far as data is concerned. For the non-personal data, we are already committee of Krish Gopal Krishnan. His work has given the draft report. You can come and file your objections. I was very clear that this whole Digital India movement to succeed, it must become a mass movement. And you have seen Common Service Center, which is close to 70,000, has become 4 lakhs. 12 lakh boys and men and women work there. They have become centers of innovation, of delivery, of digital literacy, including pre-litigation advice, of giving land records, of making passports, of the, all the government entitlements. I'm very happy it has become a mass movement. And many of them have turned innovators also during these COVID challenging times. Similarly, in this pandemic lockdown, 1,70,000 crore package was transferred. Nearly 70,000 crore directly to the bank account of the poor. And where there was no bank account or ATM, my postal people went on even boats to deliver it through their mobile digital platforms. The whole ecosystem has risen very well, and India has become the biggest center of digital payment in the world. Just to give you two examples, in 2016-17, it was 1,392,000 crore, the transaction. In 19-20, it was 2.697 lakh crore, the digital payment transactions. And the UPI, again, the products of India. In July 2020, the transaction is worth 2.62 lakh crore during the COVID period. I'm skipping the other big narratives of the past. Therefore, from inclusion to empowerment to literacy to mass movement to digital payment to software products, it has become active on all the front. I would like the gathering today to give further suggestions. There must be good norms to follow cyber security. The internet must be safe and secure, must be trustworthy. And therefore, the terrorist or others should not be allowed to abuse it. And there must be low-cost product as well, for to cater to the cyber security needs of the smaller enterprises. But what is important is that the world is looking towards India in the success of Digital India, which is transformative, which is empowering, and has shown the right way. And the world is seeking to explore and emulate it. That's very satisfying. We'll continue this pursuit of India's digital empowerment. Thank you.
CNBC TV 18 and Google presents Digital India Vision 5.0.
Thank you, Minister. Indeed, the focus on empowerment, inclusion and transformation is what's helping keep the engine of the Indian economy running, where people are able to work from home despite the current pandemic. Whether it's a student learning through their mobile screens, a patient able to consult remotely, or farmers getting government benefits directly in their bank account. Which brings us to the next item on our agenda, a discussion on powering the digital economy. India is slated to create over $1 trillion of economic value from the digital economy in 2025 with its reach transforming diverse sectors. Now, the nature of business itself is seeing a massive shift with organizations embracing digital first as a key part of staying competitive and creating value for the entire chain. Cross-section of leaders from the world of banking, technology and health to discuss how they unlock value from this immense digital economy opportunity. Our panelists are Bijit Bhaskar from ICICI Bank, Shailesh Kumar Dave from Zoho, Manish Anandani from Johnson & Johnson Consumer Health, Karan Bajwa from Google Cloud India, and of course moderating this discussion is Reema Tendulkar from CNBC TV 18.
CNBC TV 18 and Google presents Digital India Vision 5.0.
Powering India's digital economy. One of the most fascinating aspects of this COVID-induced recession is the sharp disconnect between its severity and technology spend. Even as large countries, including India, have seen a record decline in growth, one of the things that stood out is the technology spend of enterprises has largely been resilient. In fact, companies have realized that technology and digital transformation are central to their business. While India has been on a digitization journey for the last 5 years, will the next 5 years see an accelerated pace of adoption? The question is, how do we unlock the trillion-dollar digital opportunity? Welcoming my esteemed panelists once again. Karan, what has been your conversation with clients? Because, you know, the sense is that in the last few months, companies which could not digitally pivot could not compete in the market. Do you expect a fast tracking, a faster adoption of digital technology?
Absolutely, Reema. Thank you very much for having us over. And there is no question about the fact that the digital adoption in this country, and we've seen in real time what has happened over the last four months, whether you look at the remote working, how organizations have been able to be productive with the use of technology. The use of technology has gone up significantly high. I'll give you a few stats on that. If you see just the payments landscape in the country, it's in every aspect, digitization is absolutely at the front and center. Just let's look at organizational behavior and how organizations have been able to be productive in these times. When COVID first hit, organizations had to kind of, you know, react to that situation. And the first thing was, how do you empower your employees to be working from home? It was very intriguing for us to know that most BCP that was in place did not stand the test of that level of remote working, and organizations had to really go and deeply adopt technology. We had seen over the years that the technology adoption in enterprises was very tiered. There were multiple tiers of technology adoption, and yet this time was a huge democratizer. Everybody needed access to technology, and everyone needed the access to same technology. So one of the first challenges was, how do you provide technology to everyone in the organization and at the same level of usage in that sense? We went out very boldly with a mindset to serve, not sell at this time. And we actually democratized the use of foundational platforms like Google Meet, which we made available to all enterprises. And we were quite intrigued to know that organizations that had a fairly strong technology organization also needed help, besides the others that did not have. There was a recent stat that was shared that in the month of June alone, there was about 1.4 billion transactions. Talk about digital payments in this country. Every aspect of supply chains coming alive through the use of digitization, every aspect of our day-to-day life, we've seen the surface area of digitization significantly increase in this time. Now, the opportunity really for us, Reema, is while we've been kind of reacting in this way in an extreme crisis, the opportunity for us is, how do we brace up now on? There will be life either with COVID or beyond COVID. How do we reinvent ourselves and do not go back to the old way of working? And in the past, digital was a core part of everyone's strategy, and where we are now, digital is the strategy. Digital was, and technology was, an enabler. most businesses, digital and technology is at the fore of the business. So the opportunity for all of us together is to reinvent the way we work, whether we are enterprises, small, medium businesses, a bank, whether we are the government. And the government has been taking huge leaps of faith in terms of the usage of technology. The government has been functional every single day of ever since COVID hit us, ever since the lockdown hit us, and that is through technology. So I clearly see that digitization has increased. It's difficult to say whether it is 2x, 4x, but clearly the digitization in this country has increased. And I really call upon all stakeholders to accelerate that adoption so India can be really a powerhouse in the global sense in terms of digitalization.
Well, absolutely. COVID has reset the entire operating environment, and it's the best time for companies to strategize to be future ready now. But Bijit, banks, especially an ICICI bank, for instance, they were the early adopters of technology. But still, were there any operations or any services which COVID forced you to digitize? And what will be the next leg of transformation for a bank like yours?
Yeah, absolutely. So while we were, as you rightly said, I think we were up there in a lot of digital offerings, be it on the mobile platform or on the internet platform. But what we realized is that there were certain things which we had taken for granted, which we thought would be, you know, you didn't need to digitize the complete, you know, the few wrinkles here and there. We realized that that needs to be done if you actually truly want to offer digital, you know, end-to-end digital services. So therefore, we had to do a little bit of changes and tweaking in some of those things. But at the same time, I think you know, it gave us a great opportunity actually to fast track certain offerings that we were probably not putting out there. So for example, today, you know, before COVID, maybe, and I wouldn't say that a savings account opening journey was fully digital. But today, because of the fact that you've got a video KYC running, you know, you have the eKYC railroads in place. We've got virtual debit cards that we offer today. Actually, you know, opening a relationship with a bank has actually become fully digital. And I think these are things that we had to stitch a few of them together during this period so that, you know, we are able to offer some of these solutions. The other thing I think that we did is that for a long time, from a bank perspective, we never thought that you could work from home. You know, so that was something because we said, you know, they said there are security challenges, there is data privacy challenges, etc. I think we were, you know, we were able to quickly adapt and adopt certain practices, which actually helped us to very quickly, within I think a matter of 2 weeks, we were up and running. You know, like as though it was a normal day, and we were actually tracking to see, as you know, how productivities are moving and whether all of them are enabled to work. And it's interesting, actually, if you see, by June mid, I think you know, from a transaction perspective, I think we were more or less there as far as transactions were concerned, until and unless there were certain transactions which couldn't be done. Like, for example, you know, if travel is shut and those things could not be done. But otherwise, we were actually up there as far as the transactions compared to pre-COVID levels were there. So it was, it actually helped us stitch a few of these things together to make it fully digital. And it also helped us look at new initiatives, which today, therefore, makes some of these journeys fully digital for a customer. And I think, therefore, the biggest benefit that, you know, the customers get is that their efficiency increases. They are actually able to tap some of the services and products which otherwise would have been difficult for us to render. And also to give, you know, smaller ticket sizes at a much more economical cost to our clients. I think these are the few benefits that we've seen out of it.
Bijit, well, I never thought that a media company like CNBC TV18 or any media company will be able to set up so many home studios for so many employees, because this whole work from home experience has been absolutely seamless even over here. So it's been a revelation for us as well. But Manish, like banks, retailers too were investing in digital, whether it was in supply chain or in the experience or in omni-channel retailing. What is next for you? How has COVID, say, changed the scale, the scope, and the timeline of your digital transformation journey?
Since believes that its strong portfolio of trusted brand and resilient teams were built for tough times like this, right? And in the last few months, a lot has been achieved and J&J continues to evolve. What we have actually done is we have done things into four parts, right? One is about consumers, second is about customers, third is about agile solutions, and fourth is about people. So I'll just go one by one. So if you actually look at from a consumer point of view, our shoppers and consumer needed products at their doorsteps, right? And we never used to deliver directly to the consumers or shoppers, but we had to adapt. So we really tied up with direct-to-consumer food delivery startups like Zomato and Swiggy to ensure that our products are also available in the doorsteps for the consumers and shoppers. Second was from our customer engagement point of view. Like we cover millions of stores across the country, which are small mom-and-pop stores to a large store. Most of the companies have actually managed the cluster or the category of store, but this was the time because of technology, we could actually manage individual store level planning and execution based on AI or ML or artificial intelligence or machine learning based solution. And we were able to give solution or the right assortment for each stores to ensure that we continue to serve our consumers and shoppers in the best possible way. We also developed a mobile-based capability for our retailers to place orders and our sales team who were not able to step out of the house, right, to collect orders in the real time. Because as you can imagine, we have thousands of people on the road every day collecting orders from millions of the stores, right? And we had to find solutions for that. Third part also on what our healthcare professional, we connect with many doctors or healthcare professional across the country, and we had to find a digital solution to actually connect them on a regular basis. And agility in solution, right? Our demand fulfillment is one of the biggest thing for any FMCG company, and last mile delivery was very important. So we ended up partnering with many startups which are in the last mile delivery space, like delivery porter, to ensure the delivery from our warehouse as well as from our distributors. Last but not the least is people and capability. We must have the right people who understand the digital way of working. And at the same time, we had to help the team build capabilities in these changing times, because this is very, very different and sometimes uncomfortable for many of us. Like you were saying about setting up studios at home, who thought the salespeople would be sitting at home and actually delivering sales? And these are changing times. And I'm very happy that the teams have actually done extremely well to adapt to this these times.
Absolutely. I just want to move now, you know, the conversation now to India as a whole. Shailesh, and if you could come in over here, it's quite clear that, you know, companies in banking or retail are clearly fast tracking their digital agenda. But the building blocks for that were already in place for the last few years. So for instance, UPI enabled cashless commerce, which benefited an ICICI bank as well as a Johnson & Johnson. What is next for India as a country, if you look at it from a five-year time horizon?
Thanks, Reena, for having us here. Actually, as you mentioned, the building blocks were laid in the last 5 years. And one of the most important things is about finance, which is the UPI. And I would say the second most important building block is about trust. Actually, even though we look at Aadhaar as an identity, this Aadhaar, eKYC, all of them kind of address the trust aspect of the business. And if you look at UPI, it addresses the finance aspect of the business. Now, for any business, these are the two pillars on which any transaction happens. So these two have been addressed well in the last 5 years. Going forward, so I would say this is like laying the digital railroad. And now we have a lot of startups within our country who are coming up and who are putting shops along these railroads by using these APIs, the Indian Stack API. And now it is for the businesses to build on top of it and kind of engage the customers more. It's not only about efficiency. What is more important here is it actually is very inclusive. For example, one of the often quoted examples of eKYC is what used to take a couple of days or a day now takes just a couple of minutes. So even though from an efficiency perspective, it's a big jump, but the more important thing is it's enabling something which used to take like 1,500 rupees per transaction has suddenly become 20 rupees per transaction. So lots of businesses that were not viable before to be included suddenly become viable. So I would say the next 5 years would be to maximize these digital railroads in terms of eKYC, in terms of Aadhaar, in terms of digital wallet, in terms of your storing of documents, all these taken to the businesses, addressing mainly the finance and the trust aspect of the business.
Okay, interesting. So you're talking about increased adoption of some of the initiatives that are already there right now. Karan, you know, talking from an SME point of view, because that is still at the end of it, 96% of India's enterprises are SMEs, and they've been hit very hard, and they did not have digital at the front end of their agenda. Do you, in your conversation now with SMEs particularly, who are pretty much operating on a shoestring budget, is their mentality changing? Are they now open to digitally transforming themselves? Are they willing to adopt, say, cloud infrastructure?
Sure. It's just coincidentally you asked me this question. I was yesterday in a discussion with some of my colleagues, and we were looking at our SMB business. In the first 6 months of this year, which is January to June, we've actually seen unprecedented growth, high double-digit growth in our SMB business. And we were actually exploring what changed. You got to explore why SMBs have been hesitant to embrace technology. I don't think it's a question of aspiration. They want access, they want ease of engagement with their customers. So it's not that their aspiration is not to not use technology. The issue has been the models of technology usage are simply not engineered for an SMB. Think about the old way of buying technology where you had to buy hardware, and then you had to buy software, and then you buy services and integration and support and worry about security and excellence and upgrades. That's simply not cut out, that model's not cut out for an SMB. An SMB wants a consumption-based model. Of course, one which is easy to consume, second, easy to pay for, and not a very high entry barrier. And that's where the whole model of consumption, we are fortunate that while of this incident is very unfortunate, while COVID's extremely unfortunate, our technology has matured to a level where consumption models are very easily available, and organizations can consume what they want, how much they want, at the pace, and pay as you go. A very wonderful example is Salesforce's organization, which actually has got a very interesting way to go to SMBs, and they're doing an absolutely amazing job in not selling technology, but in solving the SMB's needs. And I think the opportunity is, while India is an amazing services business, we've created a $200 billion IT services business in this country through a talent-based, skill-based model. I think the opportunity for India now in these times is to actually fundamentally reinvent itself around the whole SaaS-based economy, the ISV-based economy, and create intellectual property, just the way Salesforce organization has created. That is the next phase of, and I'm just taking an IT services technology industry view of the world, that is the next phase for India. So back to the point on SMBs, SMBs are adopting technology in a way more bold manner because consumption models are today available and mature enough that actually allow them to use technology in solving their problem and not using technology and then having to worry about how do you run. These organizations do not have IT shops inside them. And they're also being serviced by a very fragmented ecosystem of partners. So it's not an ideal way for an SMB to engage. So I think it's the consumption-based model that is allowing them to be much more bolder. And that's the opportunity both for the SMB as well as the Indian technology industry to reinvent itself.
Actually, I just want to get in some thoughts on what could be the next wave of digitization. Up until now, we've made a lot of progress on fintech as a sector, but many sectors have lagged behind. And, you know, at the start of it, Gautam was talking about how education, healthcare, agriculture, these are ripe for digitization as sectors. Manish, you know, your thoughts on that, and what could be the potential constraints, or what should we do right now so that these sectors, education, agriculture, healthcare, could go down that fintech way in terms of digitization?
Yeah, so Reema, first of all, the journey has been very good in the digital economy. And I see a few challenges in the digital economy, or let me put it this way, that what are the things we can actually accelerate it? First is we need to make sure that our infrastructure really improves significantly faster than what we plan to, what we have planned. More number of Wi-Fi hotspots, making sure that the small and medium enterprises still try to adopt this much faster than what we are expecting it to. Entry-level smartphones don't have enough capability to allow a smooth internet access, right? Because we deal with multiple small enterprises across the country.
And the biggest challenge they have is the transaction cost, as Salish mentioned earlier. Even though it's come down from 500 to 20, but the 20 for a retailer is still a very high cost, right? So how do we really reduce the cost? And the last but not the least is skilled manpower in the digital space, because the market is changing, and hence the manpower also has to change in terms of capability for it to really accelerate further.
Biju, just very, very quickly, if you could throw in what, according to you, would be the big ideas the government as well as the industry needs to work on.
I think, you know, what is going to happen is, as you rightly said, the digital footprint actually, I think, is coming because of the digital transactions that are there. And I think the next set where we will actually truly see this, or the whole thing play out, is I think our ability to democratize credit. Because your ability to underwrite credit with more and more digital footprint, I think will just ensure that, you know, every strata of the society can actually get credit, and easy credit and fast credit. I think that's going to be a big, you know, game changer that's going to happen in the next couple of years. And I think there are a lot of work which, you know, the industry as well as the Reserve Bank of India, all of this, I know there are certain platforms that are being built and railroads being put, which actually will help, you know, ensure that this is delivered and this is met. I think that's going to be a big game changer.
Shailesh, you want to add to that? You know, Karan spoke about how digital literacy is actually improving. You spoke about concerns surrounding finance and privacy have been addressed up until now. But to make it to that $1 trillion in terms of India's digital economy, what more needs to be done?
Yeah, I would say one of the core beliefs in the organizations in here is like, can do a rural revival using the cloud. So what that would mean is, can the rural economy be revived if we can use the cloud more effectively? So towards this, I think there are three important things that government in anyway have to provide. One is the road, other is the electricity, and third is the connectivity. Actually, even electricity, you can go off-grid using solar. But if you want to have good, unless you have good connectivity, the cloud cannot reach the rural environment. So it's very important to have the internet connectivity going all around the nooks and corners of India. So on the second thing is, what other improvements could be made is, as Manish was mentioning, digital skilling is very important. And these three points together will make a big difference.
Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining in. Some great insights coming in on how to make India a leading digital nation. Thank you again for joining and listening in.
CNBC TV 18 and Google presents Digital India Vision 5.0.
Thank you, Rima. Indeed, a very interesting panel. And as you can see, at the intersection of all these ideas, it's cloud computing and its application, which have enabled new ways to work and deliver value for customers, even amidst massive disruption. But this movement is not just a reaction, rather it's the result of the pioneering spirit of business in India, where early adopters spotted the benefits of a digital-first strategy and overcame issues around their legacy-based systems to successfully navigate their digital transformation journey. So the big question, how do enterprises take charge of their digital destiny? We will find out in a very interesting exchange of ideas slated next with two brands that you could say have built India. Amul and Maruti represent the very best of the idea of India for both today and tomorrow. We are now joined by Dr. R.S. Sodhi from Amul and of course Shashank Srivastava from Maruti to share their insights on the topic in a fireside chat with Parikshit Luthra from CNBC TV 18.
CNBC TV 18 and Google presents Digital India Vision 5.0.
Hello, welcome to Digital India Vision 5.0 Summit in collaboration with Google India. We're talking about the digital destiny here. We're living in times of COVID-19, and companies around the world are imbibing digital technology. They're working from home, and they're trying to leverage digital marketing spend on digital promotions have been going up as well. So how are Indian companies, some of India's older and iconic companies, making that transition to digital? We're joined by the representatives of two of India's oldest companies and would represent India in one way. Maruti Suzuki's Executive Director of Sales and Marketing, Shashank Srivastava. He'll have a thing or two to say about how dealerships. We also have with us Mr. R.S. Sodhi, who's the MD of Amul India. He'll tell us how Amul is leveraging digital amidst COVID-19 as well. Mr. Sodhi, thank you very much. I'd like to begin with you. These have been difficult times for the Indian industry. Tell us how Amul really began its digital journey a few years ago.
Well, Parikshit ji, when you talk digital transformation or technology or interface, generally in our mind we think only within our cycle is either the organization or the consumers. I think in Amul, if you see, the digital transformation is being used through our whole supply chain, and supply chain is C2C, cow to consumer, or B2C, buffalo to consumer. So it starts with our digital interface with the 3.6 million farmers who are our supplier. So we have got an app-based digital technology where farmers come to know about how much milk he has poured in the society, what quality, how much money has been credited in his account, and what is the balance. Similarly, the village cooperative society is adopting digital technology to know how much milk has come, what is the temperature of the milk in the bulk milk cooler. Our district universe plants are there. They are digitally connected with the our village cooperative society through automatic milk collection system. They know which part of the district, how much milk is lying in, what BMC, what temperature, which farmers are given, not given, so all these things. This is about the milk procurement.
Right.
Similar technologies are for providing veterinary services, for breeding. All this is app-based system.
Right.
Then also digital technology is applied in the about 10,000 milk tankers which are fitted with GPS. To know how much each tanker has collected from each society, what temperature, what is the fat. So this up to the district union plant, the whole interface, whole system is connected through digital technology in app-based. So it is making system very transparent, efficient and updated.
So Mr. Sodhi, you're also been telling us how you're also connected with your farmers through the digital sphere. Tell us how that happens, how that interaction happens.
Well, simple. A farmer has got an app called automatic milk collection system. As soon as the farmer goes and he puts milk in a container, automatic milk weighment is done, quality is checked, and the other details are entered in the hardware of the computer, and then immediately on his app he gets the message or through SMS as an app that how much milk he has given, what was the quantity, and what is the fat, because payment is based on the quality and the weight. And then immediately the 232 rupees has been credited in your account and this is the balance in your bank. Then digitally money is transferred in his account. And then he can withdraw digitally, he can transfer, or he can go to the ATM and etc. That is the thing.
Okay. Also, COVID-19 is hastening the transition of several companies to digital. Tell us about how Amul would be leveraging digital applications, social media more in the weeks and months to come.
You see, this during this COVID, it is because of our adaptation to digital technology that we could continue with our supply chain of 3.6 million farmers one side, 10,000 road milk tankers, 10,000 distributors, 84 dairy plants, and 66 our hubs or the warehouses, and about a million retailers alive, well connected, without a single minute disruption. Now coming to the distribution, but that is also very important. The whole, all our 1 million retailers are connected through our distribution management system. And during COVID, we also came out with an app which is called AmulTrack, where retailers could place order with their respective distributors, because physically for the distributor going to a shop was difficult. So like you are placing your order on e-commerce, Amazon or Flipkart, retailers are placing order with their respective distributor to get the goods.
Okay.
Similarly, if you are a consumer, you want to buy Amul butter or Amul cheese, there is an app-based locate Amul. So you can know which shop nearer to my house is having Amul milk. So you are not to search for it.
Alright, very interesting.
And that interaction with consumer, really, we have, I think, I can say our innovation is a jackpot for us. I'll give just one example.
Okay.
During this COVID, 130 days COVID, on 110 days, we had live session on Facebook, where more than worth the best 750 chefs came live and given recipes for cooking at home, because everybody was sitting at home.
Everybody.
And you know how much reach we got? I mean, the total reach, if I tell you about this, during this, about 760 million Facebook watch.
Oh, that's a big number. 760 million.
Yeah. 760 million views we got in 110 days, where every day 11 shows. No other social media, no other, and let me tell you, without much any cost.
Right.
The social media or digital technology doesn't mean cost.
That is the interesting thing. You know, Mr. Sodhi, I'll come back to you again, but that is the thing. Digital helps us reduce costs, maybe manpower as well, but I'd like to get in Mr. Srivastava at this point. Mr. Srivastava, the auto industry has been also going through a transition. At Maruti itself, India's largest car maker has been trying to go digital as far as bookings and the entire sales process goes. How has that experience been amidst COVID-19?
Yeah, so actually, Parikshit, just to give you a perspective and a background, we actually started developing this digital platform a long time before this COVID thing happened. So, initially, the digital inquiry levels were actually very small, just about 3% of our total inquiries. But post-COVID, it has now reached almost 35% level, much more than that gold standard of inquiry, which is the walk-ins. So I think our experience has been that post-COVID, there has been an acceleration in terms of people wanting to use digital means for both booking, inquiry, as well as for other forms of interaction with during the car buying process. So, and in fact, for car buying is a very involved purchase. We have 26 touch points during the purchase of the car. 21 of them are actually already digitized. And the balance three, two cannot be digitized because it's physical delivery and the test drive. But the balance three, we are also digitalizing by way of e-financing, which is the only part which is not yet digitalized. So it's been a great experience. We have seen a big uptick, and I think the process was already on. It's been accelerated post-COVID.
But you know, this is the question that we often ask the industry. Is this only a temporary phenomenon? Yes, right now we're in the middle of COVID-19. We're looking at numbers rising, not just in India, but across the world as well. But what if things start changing after some time, when we have a vaccine, number of cases start coming under control? Do you think this is this digital transformation that we're seeing right now, is it a temporary phenomenon, Mr. Srivastava, or do you feel that these online sales patterns, these online service requests, this is now going to be a permanent feature going forward? This is a change in customer behavior for the good and permanently as well.
Yeah, so I feel my take is that it's a permanent feature. There is no going back now. As it is, as I've been telling, the last 3 years, it was increasing. It's nothing to do with COVID, actually. COVID is already accelerating the process. It is now, I think, irreversible. And that's what we have found in the last 3 years, not just post-COVID. So I think going forward, it is not just about the inquiry trackings or the consumer interaction, but also for the organizations, whether it is in terms of marketing, whether it's in terms of media spends. The, you know, the penetration for internet in India with almost 600 million users now, even in the tier 2, tier 3 cities, is pretty high. That boundary is also disappearing. So I think going forward, this is clearly a process which is irreversible. If at all, right, it's going to get bigger. And I'm now talking not just about inquiries and customer interaction, but in other areas as well. So whether it is marketing, the marketing mix, the communication, including processes, building efficiencies, I would even go for design, and even things like supply chain and production also will be. There is no going back on that.
But do you also feel like Mr. Sodhi was speaking about how this helps you reduce costs and reach a large number of people? We saw Maruti having a digital launch recently of their new SUV, newly launched SUV, S-Cross.
Yes.
So do you think this is also going to be a permanent feature, and this helps to reduce costs in a big way? If this launch was a success, do you think the auto industry will now go for more of these digital launches, and those brand launches and expenditures?
Yeah, so I think that's going to be a mix depending on the type of vehicles, but increasingly so. Yes, you are right. The experience with digital launches has been really good. Of course, you sort of miss the direct connect, the eye connect with the media or with the audience in general. But I think looking at the efficiencies, looking at the reach, it's the way forward. And remember, Parikshit, I've been saying this, and I think you have also been noting it when our interactions, that earlier we were talking about the digitalization of the lower end of the funnel, which is the conversion of consumers. But we are now increasingly talking even for brand awareness, for reach, and for consideration scores, KPIs to go up for brands. We are talking about using digital means. And that is the reason why, if you talk of expenditure in terms of digital, even in media, for Maruti Suzuki, I can tell you, almost 30% of our expenditure is now digital media. It used to be just 2 to 4% about 5 years back. So I think there is, it's been done because we find efficiencies, because we find reach. It's also because it helps us in our overall brand awareness.
Right. Mr. Sodhi, to get you back in, what we've also seen during this pandemic is a large majority of the workforce working from home. Do you also see that happening? We've seen how tech companies, many of them are now permanently asking employees to work from home because they feel that that is something that can be easily managed. It helps you to reduce real estate costs, office space, etc. Do you see the transition in Amul as well? Do you think a large part of your workforce, or probably some percentage of yours, can continue working from home permanently?
Well, Parikshit, you're right. Like Srivastava mentioned, during this COVID lockdown, one of the biggest discovery is our development of confidence and trust on our remote working through digital technology. I mean, this has increased our confidence. People are working from home. Earlier, we were slightly not very, confident that it can work. But there are certain works which cannot be done from home. So those will come. But I think we'll continue to work through remote or digital, whether the meetings or the travels or the work or monitoring or the dashboard. I mean, it has increased tremendously, and like Mr. Srivastava mentioned, it will continue. I think the first thing is we have to reduce our physical meetings to more to digital meetings.
Okay. Mr. Srivastava,
that is going to happen.
Do you also see that happening? We've been talking only digitally for the last 3 to 4 months. I've not had a person-to-person meeting. But do you see that happening at Maruti as well, that you will reduce the number of people in office, use the digital space to interact with your own employees? Many of them may continue working from home. Do you see that happening at Maruti?
Yeah, so listen, on our production side and the other sides, obviously you have to put the vehicles together. So obviously that option of working from home doesn't exist there. But on the office side, yes, you can have a lot of interaction working from home. Having said that, I think there are some other things which are also related, which may actually require sort of a face-to-face meeting. For example, when we meet with dealers, it's not just about phone call or email. It's also building some sort of relationship based on your, you know, human interaction. So I think that is what would probably see both the systems coexist there. It's not going to be work from home completely, but it's going to be a mix, I suppose.
I will now take the final comments from both of you. Mr. Sodhi, I'll start with you. Tell us about one big step that Amul is working towards as far as its digital transformation goes.
Right, when leave us a code, one step which we have just about 2-3 days back we have finalized through Niti Aayog, on which we are going to work, is improving the breeding. I mean, how to detect heat among the animals and provide digitally map it and provide AI and then detect the pregnancy through digital technology. That is we are going to work, because that is a technology which will give minimum 80 to 90,000 crore rupees benefit to Indian meat producer if we can really integrate digitally these two functions, heat detection and pregnancy detection, so that timely action can be taken.
Okay, Mr. Shashank, final comments from you. One step, one major step that Maruti will be working towards as far as its digital transformation goes?
Yeah, so we are very clear. We have huge amounts of transactional data so far, relating to insurance, finance, sales, and also interactional data, which is relating to, inquiries and relating to other interaction, including website interaction. We want to build a big data lake and have a single view of customer using this and get into a predictive modeling of consumer behavior and then build efficiencies for a better selling and a better marketing to our consumers.
All right, Mr. Shashank Srivastava, Mr. Sodhi, thank you very much for joining us in CNBC TV to speak about the transformation of two of India's most iconic companies. Thank you for watching and goodbye.
Thank you.
And thank you, Parikshit. And of course, thank you to the panelists. Now you can understand why a brand like Amul or Maruti stands the test of time. And of course, you also have to remember that a key part of making Digital India a success moving forward is going to be making the internet accessible to everyone. Now that's a tall order, as bringing the next billion people on screen comes with its own needs and challenges. Now, Google has been at the forefront of making this dream a reality all over the world, and their focus on India is exemplified with a recently announced $10 billion investment fund to accelerate adoption of digital services. That includes everything from enabling affordable access to information for every Indian in their own language to expanding tech infrastructure and leveraging AI for social benefit in areas that include agriculture, health, and education. Now, to share their insights on transforming India's internet economy and building for a billion, we are now joined by Sanjay Gupta and Cesar Sen Gupta from Google India in conversation with Shireen Bhan from CNBC TV 18.
Well, it is now time to talk about building the next billion or for the next billion. And joining us here on this special edition of Digital India Vision 5.0 is Cesar Sen Gupta, the Vice President, Next Billion Users, Google, and Sanjay Gupta, the Country Manager and VP Sales and Operations at Google India. Gentlemen, thanks very much for joining us here on CNBC TV 18. Cesar, let me start by asking you, and we saw that big $10 billion announcement that Sundar Pichai made, and that is a vote of confidence about Google's belief in the India story. But break it up specifically for me, the journey so far, and when you look forward, what are you now most excited about?
Look, thank you so much for having us. if you think about the future of computing and you look at where the world is going, it's very clear that the future of the internet is in the hands of the next billion users. And India is actually absolutely at the center of that change. The way most of us have used computers so far is going to be very different from how our future users, the next 100, 200, 300, 500 million people use computing. Mm. And we feel that a lot of those trends will come from India. We want to be part of that. We want to help serve the users and build the right kind of product that we can, so that we can enable them to make the best of their life.
Okay, yes, it is about empowering and enabling users. But, you know, let me talk a little bit about that announcement that came in, the $10 billion to fund India's digital economy over the next 5 to 7 years. You know, Sundar gave us some sense of the kind of products that you will be focusing on, the kind of sectors that you will be focusing on. And that pretty much reflects the kind of work that Google has done in India so far. So, in terms of next steps now, break it up for us about what we should realistically expect when we talk about that fund that has been allocated for India specifically.
Sanjay, you want to take that?
Yep. I think, hi, Shireen, and happy to be here. I think as Sridhar said, that we are looking at a new set of users coming in, and fundamentally the needs are very different. I think just to classify, one, I think people will see when they come from different income strata, they would need to get internet connectivity at a much lower cost in terms of, so I think the one big idea would be to provide access to next 100 and 500 million consumers by providing them an affordable smartphone. Second, they would look for information, which is unique and different, because the kind of things that they're engaged in, how they grow their productivity will be very different. So people in urban areas may seek different information. But when you go to a rural setup, people may support agricultural information. And thirdly, the way we can solve bigger problems of India, like education, health, or agriculture, would require very different institutions that we may need to plan for. And therefore, a lot of investments may go into forging new partnerships or being a catalyst of change in society for new entrepreneurs to come in to solve those problems.
Yes, you've talked about many things, but let's pick up on the aspect of partnership that you spoke of. And I want to speak specifically about one big partnership, and everyone's waiting to get more clarity on that. Sridhar, let me get you to give us some indication of what we should expect. And that is the plan on using the Android operating system in partnership with Jio to actually be able to put a low-cost smartphone, whether it's 4G or 5G, in the hands of the consumer. Now, this was the big announcement that was made at the Reliance AGM by the chairman, Mukesh Ambani. Sundar spoke about this as well. You know, how soon? What's the aspiration? What's the plan?
Look, we don't have any specific details right now. I think there's a lot of stuff we are working on. But we're extremely excited about the partnership with Reliance and sort of you know, Mr. Ambani's vision for how he wants to bring on so many people onto the internet. We think, you know, working together, we'll be able to further the effort that we've been on for many years to make Android be available to many, many more people at lower cost and at equally high quality.
Okay, so I would imagine that this is going to be a little bit of a marriage of the hardware as well as the software, and then comes the bundling of the various apps, which ties in with your aspiration of being able to connect Indians as well as provide them with access to information, etc. So, you know, how do you see this ecosystem developing as you plan for this low-cost smartphone revolution, if I can call it that?
So I think it will be very similar to the Android ecosystem. Android is an open ecosystem. It's an open source operating system. So those principles and that core of Android is not changing. I think what we're doing here is taking forward the journey we've been on for a while of like really specifically delivering stuff that users in India care about. And especially if you think about it, every 100 million new users in India, the usage changes. What they want from the internet changes. And so we want to make sure we are at the forefront of that, and we are ready when they are by them.
Okay. Sanjay, let me ask you, you know, since Cesar just spoke about the fact that you want to be at the forefront of technology and innovation, and that is also something that Sundar Pichai spoke of, saying that the goal is to ensure that India not only benefits from the next wave of innovation, but also leads it. So again, how should we read that? And let me ask you this in the context of what you've been able to do as far as Google Pay is concerned, because that has been acknowledged by Google that a lot of the innovation that's happened with the payment system here in India is probably what you're going to take to the payments products globally as well. So when you talk about India leading tech innovation, what should we expect next?
So I think, Shireen, the way we have seen India evolve, and NBU really helped us. One big learning we have is that if we solve for India, we solve for the world in some way. I think the users are demanding, and the users are in different environments. And when you solve for those challenges, they work, we believe, globally. And look at the example of Google Pay.
Yeah.
It is designed and developed for India. And now we have rolled it out globally. I can take another example of Google Golo, which is an app that we developed to teach young kids to learn the language by using speech-to-text recognition. Now, fundamentally, we launched it in India in many languages. We have today more than 3 million kids using it across 28,000 villages, downloading more than 26 million stories. And as we saw this develop, we realized that this could be taken globally. So we are in the process of now launching Google Bolo into Google Read-Along. So I fundamentally believe that India is giving us an opportunity to innovate sharply for the needs and then roll some of those products locally out. And we see that happening more often now as we move forward.
You know, you've talked about two important areas where you hope to bridge the deficit that we see, whether it's education or it's information. And Sanjay, let me pick up first on Google Pay, because digital inclusion, financial inclusion is part of the government's mandate as well. And you're trying to play a role in that along with many others. The competitive landscape, and it's getting increasingly more competitive. And the attempt to try and use Google Pay to bridge the deficit when it comes to the SMB sector, because that's also a crucial area that you intend to focus on. Now, you've done innovations with Google Pay to address that constituency specifically. So what more should we expect on the payment side when we talk about financial inclusion and your play there?
So let me make 2 points there. First, I think, is around the competition that you talked about. I do think there is such huge space for growth right now, and more competition is leading to better innovation. So if you look at the number of UPI payments which happened in the month of June, it was 1.34 billion transactions. A year back in June 2019, there were 750 million transactions.
Yeah.
So clearly the market is exploding, and we do think 2 years down the line, there could potentially be a billion transactions a day on UPI. So I think there's enough space to grow, and fundamentally there is a big impact that all the players in the market can make to really grow that faster and have faster digital adoption in the country. And to me, that really opens up many opportunities. But one of the opportunities I think it fundamentally opens up is a lot of people in SMB in particular today do not have a financial history and therefore do not have access to capital. And I think what platforms like Google Pay and many more such platforms can do is really enable that to happen. So I think one of the biggest unlocks that payment system will provide digitally is the access to capital for the SMB. I think it's a critical key for the growth of SMB.
You talked about SMBs and the access to capital, and that's one of the aspirations that payment platforms like Google Pay are hoping to capitalize on. What's the latest number? You know, the last number that I had for the month of May, 7.5 transacting users in May of 2020. What's the latest number as far as Google Pay is concerned? And what's the current market share?
Cesar, you want to take that?
I was going to say, the last number we shared was at Google for India last year, which was, I think, 67 million. The product's obviously gone further. We aren't quite ready yet to share another updated number, but we're very happy with the way users are adopting Google Pay, as well as how SMBs are adopting Google Pay. And I think this there's still a long, long way for us to go, so we're hard at work to try to make sure we build the right product for not just the users we have today, but the next several million, 100 million people who come online.
Okay, you won't give us the latest number, but the latest number though is available. At least the number that I have is 7.5 crore transacting users in May of 2020. But Cesar, since you spoke about Google Pay and SMBs, is the focus now going to be much more sharply on enterprise when it comes to the payment side of the business?
Look, a big part of our focus is on enabling users to do more with businesses. Hmm. So enterprise in terms of like larger merchants have had fairly wide acceptance of UPI and through that to Google Pay. I think a big focus for us is just enabling small businesses to do a lot more. I think enabling them to take payments is the first stage. But as Sanjay talked about, there are more services we can build for them. Mm. One of the things that I was really proud of that we managed to get done during the lockdown was we enabled a feature where small businesses can just list basic stuff like bread and atta and things like that that were available.
Yeah.
And users could find these products in their neighborhood. Mm. And those kinds of features I think are really powerful. So I think over the next few months, quarters, we'll see a lot more of attention onto like building out services so we can help the SMBs grow their business and help users do more digitally.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of digital transformation, and you talked about what this pandemic has done in terms of acceleration, and we've seen it across a bunch of sectors, not just financial, but also education. So Sanjay, let me ask you about the aspirations as far as education are concerned, and distance learning, online education just shot through the roof because schools were shut down, colleges are closed, and so people have no choice but to actually make this digital pivot. So what is it that you intend to do in this space? You're already working with about 22,000 schools, I'm given to understand, to train teachers, to get them access to Google services. What's the larger aspiration as far as the education space is concerned? And will it be done organically? Are we likely to see you make more investments in this space? You've already done some in companies and startups like QMath. What's the future looking like?
Yeah, Shireen, I think that's a really good question. I do think there are more than 300 million kids who today don't have access to education because they can't go to schools. No teachers can come to their schools. I think that is one area that we really focused on in the last 5-6 months. What the three areas that we are really focused on? One is providing access and enabling teachers to go digital.
Yeah.
So we announced around 2 weeks back a joint partnership with CBSE. Mm-hmm. We're enabling around 1 million teachers to learn to go digital to Teach from Home Hub that we launched. Mm. We have just announced yesterday a big initiative with Maharashtra State Government.
Okay.
Where we want to ensure that 2.3 crore children in Maharashtra are able to use hybrid learning by using the power of Google Classroom, Google Meet, and other Google products like Google Polo and YouTube Learning to really make them effective. But I think at the fundamental core level, I feel education is one area which can game change with technology. And I think one of the big challenges of society at large is that at a very young age, kids don't get access to quality information. Mm. So in the foundation years, the understanding of a language or understanding of basic math skills is very poor.
Yeah.
And we do believe that at grade 3 to grade 4 is the transition year for the kids. So I think better technology, better content can help kids learn significantly more and therefore increase their overall learning potential over the next decade or so as they go through school and college.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the big area for focus for us beyond infrastructure would be enabling using technology, some of those areas by using technology to help learning and by assessment of people.
That's important, and let me get you both to build on that a little bit more, Sanjay. You talked about a partnership with CBSE. You spoke about the partnership with the government of Maharashtra to further the efforts that you're making on the education front. Are we likely to see many more of these partnerships, especially with state governments, because education is a state subject? And, what is the nature of these partnerships? I understand that you're going to be trying to provide access to digital services and the whole suite of services that Google has to offer, but how is it going to work exactly?
So I think I'll go back to the mission that we have as Google in India, which is about making internet helpful for a billion Indians.
Hmm.
And that really drives us in terms of how we think about what partnership we do and where to focus on. And we do believe, keeping that in mind, education becomes an important area that we can contribute deeply. So we're trying to partner with people like CBSE. People are into education already. NGOs who are working, non-profits who are working in the space of education or governments, to enable Google resources to be used more meaningfully, to reach out and for kids to learn now and in future. So fundamentally, it is about enabling as many kids as possible in the country to access quality education. And all our products, which is Google Classroom or Google Bolo, as you know, come free of cost.
Yeah.
We don't charge for it from our consumer point of view. And even on YouTube, we launched something called YouTube Learning in the last few months, which is all about giving access to quality content to all our kids to ensure that they can learn. So I think fundamentally, it's all about enabling the society to learn better using Google products.
Cesar, let me get you to take that forward and link that to the aspiration that you have to sort of deepen and broaden the efforts on the language side. It's not just language, but you also want to focus much more on video. So how is this all going to tie up and tie together, especially the efforts that you're making on education as well as language?
I think that's a great segue into one of the big trends that's going to come up, that is coming up in India, which is both the vernacular usage, as well as the fact that the next billion users prefer video and voice as a format for with which to engage. So I think, you know, a big area for focus for us right now is trying to figure out how we deliver the right kind of information, first of all, to users through these mediums, enable them to do a lot more using voice and video. And then think about like how we can, you know, translate that to education and other services and products we're doing.
You know, one of the interesting things that Google has been working on in India for a while now is the Internet Sathi project. So what are the learnings from there that you hope to now incorporate into what you hope to do going forward, Cesar?
I think for Internet Sathi, look, it's been a really inspiring program, seeing how women in villages can help other women learn about the importance of the internet. And we've seen how it's actually helped people expand what they do, both in terms of their personal life, but also in terms of businesses. One of the learnings here really was how can we help users help their communities around them, as well as the importance of really localizing ourselves. And so, you know, Internet Sathi working together with Tata Trust, as we were able to go into the states, be able to help people in their own languages, I think was a pretty big learning for us. So I think we want to do more in partnership with local organizations, in partnerships with organizations that are deeply rooted in the communities around the world, around India.
Yes, that certainly seems to be working for you. But, you know, Sanjay, let me ask you about something that's playing out globally as well. And since you're talking about providing access to accurate, credible information, what we're now seeing with the tech world globally, with regulators looking at this issue as well, is that, look, how do you ensure that what information is being provided on this on your platforms is accurate, it's verifiable, it's credible, it's without biases, and is it even possible? And what steps specifically are you planning to take? I mean, we've seen what Twitter has decided to do to pull down tweets, etc. What steps are you likely to take in a market like India?
So that's a really, really good question, Shireen. And I think let me answer that question by taking an example of COVID-19, because that is the really test case of what consumers are looking for. They're looking for credible information. They're looking to get it in their own language. They're looking to get it on their phone in the internet connectivity that they have. Now, fundamentally, what we did there was to partner deeply with Ministry of Health and Family Welfare to get the right information and with WHO. Because that becomes the really right credible information. And then you work deeply, very hard to ensure that's available in every language that consumers access the internet in. So I think at Google, we take this whole idea of providing credible information in their own language very seriously. So I do, that's a good test case of how this information is right and credible. And the biggest example of that was when we had the migrant challenge.
Yeah,
there were more than 11,000 food shelters in the country. Now, how do you provide this information to consumers in an easily accessible manner? It was an important job to be done. And I think What we did was put a lot of people and manpower, but ensure that this information is available not only on Google Search, but places like Google Maps, so that you can actually figure out the latitude, longitude, and go to the destination where people need to go, either to provide food or to get food. So I think, so in my mind, I think we put a lot of effort and emphasis in shaping right and credible information. And to be honest, there is no better example than COVID to really underline that both commitment and trust that we've been able to win with customers and consumers. Because in those 8 weeks, we had more than 2 billion inquiries or searches on different global Google platforms.
You know, you spoke about the partnership specific to COVID with the Ministry of Health and the WHO to ensure that accurate information is being disseminated across the platform. But as you move forward, do you believe that there will be a need to nurture, forge more partnerships to be able to do so? And what are you looking at?
So absolutely. I think as Cesar talked about earlier, that the internet users are changing very dramatically. And we are looking at very different kind of users coming in. Some of the information that they're seeking doesn't exist necessarily. If I take about agriculture as an example, the information on crops, the pricing, the mandi, all has to be made available to consumer for them to get more value out of what they are farming. So I do think it will require new partnerships and new ways to ensure that we actually ensure that the ecosystem in India on the back of what Google does, and Google acts as a catalyst for that ecosystem to come together to provide the meaningful information to every consumer as they speak differently in the new environment of the new users.
I think if I can build on that, Shireen, you know, if you look at any Google product today, we're generally an ecosystems and a platform company. So what we try to do is build a platform that brings like one set of people providing the services or information together with the users. And so as we look at newer and newer areas of where we can be of service, I think that's exactly the approach we could take. We took the same approach that Google made, where we brought the bank together with our users and sort of created an ecosystem around that. And so that's sort of the approach that we take to partnerships for pretty much everything we do.
You know, I want to ask both of you, since we're talking about reliable information and reliable data, I've started to see this trend over the last few months where a lot of people are now tracking Google data, for instance, the Google mobility data, to talk about the state of the economy and the pace of recovery. So how do you read that? And you know, is this something that you believe you know, we're likely to see much more of, perhaps even as a service, because there's a lack of credible data today that we're dealing with? Either of you could take a stab at this.
You know, we feel a tremendous amount of responsibility when people use Google. So we try to make sure like all of our data is, you know, we've done the best possible work to present it in the right way. But, you know, this has been something that people have always depended on Google for, looking for great information. I mean, Google Trends in the past was a great way to look at, like, you know, how people are searching, how users are behaving. And mobility, this is part of the reason why we worked on releasing the mobility reports. So we're happy. And, you know, if there's ideas people have on what, how we can be of service more, we'd be happy to be of service.
Okay. You know, Sanjay, I want to talk to you about this digitization fund that you've announced. Of course, a significant portion of that is has gone to Jio. But if I were to look at what's happened with Google, as well as the investments that the VC arm has made over the past decade, you know, hundreds of them across the world globally, I think to the tune of 900 plus. What's the plan as far as India is concerned? You've been relatively slower on the investments in startups in India relative to what we've also seen in terms of scale in this region. So what should we expect now as far as the investment roadmap for the Indian startup ecosystem?
So I think what our belief in India is that we should ensure that the private enterprise thrives here. And I think what we'll do is to use this investment very easily for areas that we believe will help catalyze the change. So I think if people can help solve problems which have not been solved so far, could be the problem that we could potentially invest in the future. That could be agriculture, health, education, or SMB. As Cesar said earlier, that we are like a platform which enables innovation to happen. So So our focus will be in enabling that innovation side in India.
Okay, the focus is going to be on the innovation side in India. But, you know, broadly, if I were to look at the kind of investments that you've made so far, Dunzo, QMath, A-Finance, are those the kinds of areas that you will be looking at? And what's the broad investment threshold that we should expect?
So I think if I can broaden the topic a little bit, you know, we try to do our best to support startups and small companies. So while we have been relatively light on investing directly into startups in India, we've done a lot of working with VCs to support startups. So there is a program called Google Launchpad Accelerator that takes startups that are very early in their life, brings them to the Google campus, helps them scale. Similarly, we work with the startups on helping them, you know, get the best out of, create the best Android apps, use the best way to use cloud. So I think those things we'll continue doing. I think in terms of investments, our focus is, we tend to approach it more from a point of view of partnerships first and then investment later. And the reality is, you know, money is not the issue in India. I think most companies in India have proved that they can raise money. The issue is in actually having the right kind of technology, the right kind of advice, and helping build companies and products that can truly scale. And that's where we hope to be of service to many companies.
You know, since you talked about partnerships and then investment, let me ask you about what the plan is as far as the connectivity side of the story is concerned. And we've seen efforts with the railways and so on and so forth. So what's next on that leg of the journey?
I think, look, you know, India, connectivity in India has been an amazing story. I mean, when we started Google Station, you know, there was no Jio. Today, with Reliance Jio and 5G in India, it's a very, very different environment. So I think that's part of the reason we wanted to work closely with Reliance Jio. We also work very closely with the other telcos in India. And you'll continue to see us doing more there to try to see how we can support them in bringing, you know, deeper and faster connectivity globally. I'm pretty excited about 5G. So let's see what 5G does in, you know, painting the chapter for India's next chapter.
Well, we don't know when 5G is going to be unveiled in India. We're still awaiting the start of the trials and then, of course, the auction. But that's a different story altogether. Sanjay, let me ask you now. You know, we're pretty much towards the second half of 2020. It's been a difficult year, to say the least, not just for India, but globally as well. Has it pushed back any of your plans for India, or has it forced you to accelerate some of your plans for India?
So I think, as you know, it has been a tough time for India in terms of lives, and people have been troubled. I think poorest have been hit the hardest actually in this pandemic. But I think the silver lining that we see is that opportunity of accelerating digitization. And India, fortunately, is a low digital country. Penetration is still less than 35%. And also, it's a very informal economy. More than 90% of the economy is informal in the country. So we see a really great opportunity on the back of digitization really shaping and accelerating digital economy in India. So we believe from a $250 billion digital economy today, potentially over the next 5 to 7 years, we could be a $1 trillion digital economy. And that we need to really invest today, invest in shaping and enabling the change from our point of view. And I do think the ecosystem, all of us, many companies like ours and many different companies will participate in shaping the change and hopefully executing that digital economy. So I do think the business has been hit, but the future should be bright over the next, over the 5 to 7 year time frame.
Well, you know, you've got a $1 trillion aspiration as far as the digital economy is concerned. So there is a significant headroom for growth. But Cesar, what do you believe are likely to be the big challenges for us to be able to grapple with in order for us to get from the 250 billion to a trillion?
I think a big part is getting digital and connectivity to many more people. I think internet connectivity is one part, but obviously getting the right kind of devices in the next stage. And then sort of being able to build the right kind of products and services that they work. And, you know, what we spoke about earlier, voice, video, vernacular, these are really key pieces. The second thing is, I think trust is very important in the system. And helping us, you know, the focus on security and enabling that digitization to happen in a way that everybody feels comfortable with it is really super key. So that's actually going to be a big part of making, helping people make the jump over to a fully digitized economy.
Cesar and Sanjay, many thanks for joining us here on the Digital India Summit. And here's wishing you and your teams the very best of luck as you grow the digital economy and get to that $1 trillion aspiration that you spoke of. Appreciate you joining us here.
Thank you so much,
Shireen. Thank you, Shireen. Well, from broad strokes, we now focus on an interesting story of how digital transformation has enabled ordinary Indians to do extraordinary things. Our next speaker is the perfect example of combining one's passion to serve the greater good. Her YouTube channel has provided free quality education spanning a wide range of topics for thousands of students across India. The lessons are easy to understand and, more importantly, are multilingual to widen viewership. Now, that explains why her channel has garnered close to 1 million subscribers. From dreaming of becoming a teacher to helping students overcome their fear of exams, this is the real story of Roshni Mukherjee from LearnoHub. Roshni is with us to talk about how content is king, language is queen. Let's listen in.
CNBC TV 18 and Google presents Digital India Vision 5.0.
Hello everyone. Thank you so much for having me here. It feels great to be a part of this huge celebration of Digital India. I would like to take the next few minutes of your time to share my journey as a digital educator as well as a passionpreneur, as you may call me. So, my digital journey shuru hui kareeb 9 saal pehle, back in 2011, when I started a free learning platform called Exam Fear Education, which is now called LearnoHub. College ke dino se hi main टीचिंग को लेके काफी पैशनेट थी. मुझे पढ़ाने का शौक था और मुझे लगता था कि मेरे अंदर वो पढ़ाने का नैक भी था. तो जब मैंने अपनी मास्टर्स कंप्लीट करी, मेरी प्लेसमेंट हो गई एंड आई स्टार्टेड वर्किंग इन द आईटी सेक्टर एज अ क्वालिटी एनालिस्ट. बट स्टिल मैं सोच रही थी कि आई शुड टीच, और मेरा गोल ये था कि आई शुड टीच एंड रीच आउट टू द मासेस. उन दिनों बैक इन 2009-10 यूट्यूब वॉज प्राइमरली यूज फॉर एंटरटेनमेंट एंड म्यूजिक. एटलीस्ट लर्निंग कॉन्टेंट की अगर हम बात करें तो यूट्यूब पर इंडिया में तो कुछ खास लर्निंग कॉन्टेंट नहीं था. So I thought, why not make use of YouTube to teach? और इसी सोच के साथ मैंने YouTube पर कुछ फिजिक्स के वीडियोज बनाए और उन्हें डाल दिए. To my surprise, मैंने देखा कि उन वीडियोज पे काफी अच्छा रिस्पॉन्स आ रहा था. बहुत से बच्चे कह रहे थे कि हमें बहुत अच्छा समझ आया मैम, आप इस टॉपिक पर वीडियो बनाओ. So I was getting lot of requests, like lot of good response. In fact, एक बच्चे ने मुझे लिखा था एक comment, जिसने मुझे इतना मोटिवेट किया था ड्यूरिंग द फर्स्ट वीक ऑफ माई फर्स्ट अपलोड. बच्चे ने लिखा था कि वॉट यू कुड एक्सप्लेन इन 10 मिनट्स माई टीचर कुड नॉट डू इन अ वीक. एंड दिस वॉज ह्यूज फॉर मी, क्योंकि उस टाइम पर जो मैं कर रही थी, जो मैंने करना शुरू किया था, इट वॉज जस्ट आउट ऑफ माई पैशन टू टीच. बट इस तरह के कॉमेंट्स पढ़ के मुझे ये समझ आया कि द स्टूडेंट्स ऑन द अदर हैंड दे आर ऑल्सो बेनिफिटिंग आउट ऑफ इट. उन्हें भी इस तरह के वीडियोस की जरूरत थी एंड दीज वीडियोस वर हेल्पिंग देम. तो मैं लाइक टोटली मोटिवेटेड और एनकरेज्ड थी. और उसी टाइम के दौरान मेरे घर पर जो काम करती थी, शी वॉज अ सिंगल मदर फ्रॉम अ विलेज इन तमिलनाडु, वो अक्सर ही कंप्लेन करती थी कि उसके दोनों बच्चे जो उसके गाँव के ही किसी छोटे से स्कूल में जाते थे, वो कभी भी एग्जाम क्लियर नहीं कर पाते हैं. मतलब उन्हें पढ़ाई में इंटरेस्ट नहीं है, स्कूल नहीं जाना चाहते हैं, कई बार क्लासेस नहीं होती हैं. तो व्हाट आई अंडरस्टूड वाज द क्वालिटी ऑफ एजुकेशन फॉर दोज किड्स वाज नॉट दैट ग्रेट. नाउ दिस वाज अ टर्निंग पॉइंट अगेन. इट वाज माय फ्रीक्वेंट इंटरेक्शन विद माय मेड जिससे मुझे लगा दैट आई शुड बिल्ड अ फ्री एजुकेशन प्लेटफॉर्म जहां पर बच्चे 24/7 पढ़ सके, कभी भी कहीं से भी पढ़ सके. इट शुड बी फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट सो दैट इट इज अफोर्डेबल फॉर एवरीवन, सब लोग अफोर्ड कर सके. एंड थर्ड एंड मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंटली, फ्री है लेकिन क्वालिटी इसकी अच्छी होनी चाहिए. फिर क्या, गाड़ी चलती रही, वीडियोस बनते रहे. 2014 में तो मैंने जॉब भी छोड़ दी और फुल टाइम वीडियोस बनाने लग गई. So by now, I have created close to 7,000 video lessons on various subjects like physics, chemistry, mathematics, biology, civics, geography, science experiments, tips and tricks. तो कुल मिलाकर आज के डेट पे हमारे तीन डिफरेंट यूट्यूब चैनल्स हैं, लर्नो हब 11th 12th, लर्नो हब 9th 10th, लर्नो हब 6th 7th 8th, एंड वी हैव क्लोज टू 1 मिलियन सब्सक्राइबर्स, वी हैव मोर देन 250 मिलियन व्यूज ऑन द कंटेंट. वी वेर इवन रिकॉग्नाइज्ड बाय लिम्का बुक ऑफ रिकॉर्ड्स फॉर क्रिएटिंग सो मच ऑफ कॉन्टेंट एंड प्रोवाइडिंग देम ऑल फॉर फ्री. तो हमने जो ये कॉन्टेंट बनाया, इसके अंदर हमने पूरा करिकुलम कवर कर लिया था फ्रॉम 6th टू 12th based on the NCERT textbooks so that it could be useful for the CBSE board as well as state boards, jiski wajah se CBSE ke chairman ne hame invite bhi kiya tha for a tie-up for their upcoming online platform called digishiksha.com. We were even recognized by the President of India for our contribution in the field of education as one of the 100 women achievers of India. हमारे इतने सालों की जर्नी में वी हैव एक्चुअली सीन द इम्पैक्ट ऑन स्टूडेंट्स अक्रॉस द कंट्री. अराउंड 2017 एक ऐसा फेज आया जब सडनली वी स्टार्टेड रिसीविंग अ लॉट ऑफ रिक्वेस्ट्स ऑन वर्नाक्यूलर कंटेंट फ्रॉम स्टूडेंट्स. बहुत ज्यादा डिमांड आने लगी कि मैम आप जो है रीजनल लैंग्वेज में वीडियोज बनाओ. सो वॉट वी रियलाइज्ड वाज एज इंटरनेट वॉज पेनिट्रेटिंग the demand for vernacular content was increasing kyunki ab hamare jo videos the ye chote chote shehron mein tier 2 tier 3 cities small towns villages even remote areas tak pahunch rahe the aur wahan ke bachchon ko wahan ki jo regional language hai wo zyada samajh mein aati hai compared to english. So looking at the huge demand that we were receiving on hindi, we thought it would be a good idea to start creating some content in hindi. So around 2018 we started creating some videos in hindi. So we started with some tips and tricks and science experiment videos and gradually moved on with different subjects. And trust me, over the last few years, over the recent few years in fact, we have received many success stories from small towns and villages. In fact, मुझे ये शेयर करते हुए बहुत 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 ज़्यादा खुशी हो रही है कि हमारे कुछ कुछ बच्चों ने बहुत अच्छा किया है लाइफ में. दीपल जैन जो हमारी एक स्टूडेंट रही हैं, 2017 में पूरे मध्य प्रदेश स्टेट बोर्ड की बायोलॉजी टॉपर रही हैं एंड शी शेयर्ड हर एक्सपीरियंस लर्निंग विथ अस इन एन इंटरव्यू विथ टाइम्स ऑफ इंडिया. नॉट जस्ट दैट, कर्नाटका के एक छोटे से गांव में रहने वाले उमेश बीजे ने हमें लिखा था कि हिज सिस्टर कुड गेट अ सीट इन अ मेडिकल कॉलेज विद द हेल्प ऑफ आवर वीडियोस. एक छोटी सी बच्ची जो एक गांव में रहती थी, जो कह रही थी कि उसे मैथ्स में बहुत दिक्कत आती थी और उसके घर के आसपास कोई मैथ्स टीचर नहीं था, और चूंकि वो लड़की थी तो घर वाले अलाउ नहीं करते थे कि बहुत दूर जाए मैथ्स पढ़ने के लिए. सो शी सेड थैंक यू सो मच मैम, यू गेव मी अ पॉकेट ट्यूटर बिकॉज नाउ आई लर्न एंड एंजॉय मैथ्स ऑन मोबाइल फोन. तो इस तरह की जो हम इसे अपनी सक्सेस स्टोरीज कहते हैं, इस तरह के जो फीडबैक है वी कीप रिसीविंग टन्स एंड टन्स ऑफ देम ऑन अ रेगुलर बेसिस. नाउ बीइंग इन दिस स्पेस फॉर क्वाइट अ लॉन्ग टाइम नाउ, we have actually seen how students, more importantly parents, who were not in favor of online learning became a fan of online learning, how the learning vertical of YouTube grew over the years, and how the viewership trend changed over the years. In fact, I personally have come across many parents who never encouraged online learning. उन्हें ऐसा लगता था कि टीचर अगर सामने बैठा नहीं रहेगा तो बच्चा डिस्ट्रैक्ट हो जाएगा. कंप्यूटर के सामने बच्चा वीडियो देख के पढ़ेगा, उसे शायद समझ नहीं आएगा, उसे मजा नहीं आएगा, तो पढ़ाई नहीं होगी ढंग से. बट लेट मी टेल यू, द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ मेनी पीपल चेंज्ड ओवर द लास्ट फ्यू मंथ्स. मार्च 2020 कोविड अटैक्ड अस, लॉकडाउन, स्कूल्स क्लोज्ड, कोचिंग सेंटर्स क्लोज्ड, ट्यूशन सेंटर्स क्लोज्ड, नो फिजिकल प्रेजेंस ऑफ टीचर्स, सो द ओनली ऑप्शन लेफ्ट वॉज ऑनलाइन लर्निंग. पिछले कुछ महीनों में बहुत से बच्चों ने हमसे कहा कि दे ट्राइड ऑनलाइन लर्निंग फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम एंड फाउंड इट इवन मोर इंटरेस्टिंग एंड एंगेजिंग बिकॉज नाउ दे हैव द फ्रीडम टू चूज वॉट दे वॉन्ट टू स्टडी एंड वेन. एक्चुअली इफ द कॉन्टेंट इज गुड, इट विल एंश्योर दैट लर्नर्स एंजॉय वॉचिंग इट. सो इट इज वेरी राइटली सेड दैट कॉन्टेंट इज किंग. इनफैक्ट वी एट लर्नो हब just try to make things simple for children, and we do it in a very, very simple way. So if you watch a video of ours, it may not be very fancy and zazzy, but we always ensure that it is to the point, simple explanation and engaging. Pichle kuch mahino mein, we have started receiving so many emails from NGOs and schools, especially in small towns, that they are using our content to teach children online. And it's, you know, it's like an amazing feeling to see that our content has been able to help so many children, so many teachers, and so many schools. I feel we are all entering into an era where education is getting revolutionized. And trust me, online learning is going to be a very powerful tool in this revolution.
Thank you, Roshni. Well, till now, we have covered many talking points around connectivity, commerce, and content, but there is still a digital divide that needs to be bridged to create a more inclusive India. Now, the digital revolution will only be truly meaningful if it positively impacts both urban and rural India in an even manner. Now, the challenge is to fill the gaps around skills, identification and access, and also address those issues from the lens of gender diversity, service personalization, and last mile connectivity. It is time now to put the spotlight on leveraging digital India to create a more inclusive India, where the impetus is not just on enhancing efficiency, but also creating a more accessible user experience, which improves connectivity between government and citizens. Joining us for this discussion, headline Digital India, Inclusive India, are Abhishek Singh from MyGov, Sangeeta Gupta from NASSCOM, and Neha Barjatia from Google India. And moderating the session is Megha Vishwanath from CNBC TV18.
Well, thank you so much for that brilliant introduction and setting the stage for this very important topic when we talk about digitizing India, because we need to ensure that we are trying to solve for the digital divide that exists as of now between India and Bharat. And unfortunately, that is the reality. And Neha, Abhishek, and Sangeeta are going to be talking to us over the next 30 minutes to talk about exactly that. What is the need of the hour and what can we do to kind of bridge that gap, which is only widening by the hour? Let me start by asking you, Abhishek, as part of MyGov, you've been working on several initiatives and that you've been doing that for many, many years now. But let's start by talking about how do you define inclusion in the first place?
See, like when you talk of digital technologies, the very concept ensures that we need to ensure equal access to each and everyone. How do we ensure that every person living anywhere in the country gets access to digital information? Because especially in a country like India, when we have a lot of people who don't have a device, who don't have connectivity, and even if they had, they would not have the skill sets to do that. So we do a lot of online activities, on-ground activities. We work very closely with the common service centers who provide assisted access. So ultimately, to ensure that information is shared equally and equitably to all, we do use all kinds of means to do that. So that is one part. The second part we do is that we try to ensure that the content is available in all languages and even to people who are differently abled, and using voice as a medium for communication. So all this ensures that information is shared without any digital divide and ensuring everybody has access to the right information.
Well, I read this recently somewhere which said that content is king, but language is queen. And I don't think anything sums it up better, especially when we are talking about this mission of digitizing India. So you have essentially spoken about skills, you've spoken about access. Let me bring in Sangeeta at this point from NASSCOM. Sangeeta, how do you define inclusion, and what would an inclusive India on a digital platform mean to you?
Thank you so much, Megha, and good evening to everybody. I think it's a very, very important topic. And from a NASSCOM perspective, we've always believed in the power of technology and what technology can do for India. And clearly, technology, I would rather not call it a digital divide, but technology can be a digital bridge between the haves and the have-nots. And I think inclusion to me is about repeating some part of what Abhishek said. It's about access, it's about opportunity, and it's the ability to progress. So I think if technology or digital technologies can help bridge all of these three areas, particularly from a rural India Bharat perspective, I think we can much more move forward as a nation than what we've seen in the past. So I'll stop here, Megha, and ask what the questions.
Okay. So Sangeeta is clearly a half glass full kind of person, because she does not look at this as a digital divide, but the fact that this can act as a bridge. And at this point, let me rope in Neha, who is the Chief Internet Sathi, which is a program that Google started in 2015. Neha, for the benefit of everybody, I would want to assume that everyone knows what this program is all about. But do some quick context setting in terms of what Google has been doing as part of its Internet Sathi program, and since this focuses on specifically women, I can preempt what inclusion means for you, but go ahead, take it away and tell us what does that mean for you.
Sure, thanks Megha. Good evening everybody. So inclusion is something I think which we very deeply care about at Google, and I'm just going to take a step back and set some context really, right? Like if we look at the internet landscape in India, we do have over 500 million internet users. And if you look at it, about 450 million of these users are using the internet through a smartphone device. And we do have one of the lowest data prices, you know, smartphone affordability is improving day by day. So we are on a good path to progress when it comes to access. And, you know, we are one of the largest and fastest growing markets. But access is only useful if there are helpful products that users can gain from. And, you know, our mission in Google in India has always been, and we've been hard at work at this, is to make the internet helpful for every Indian. And I think that every Indian is where, you know, the inclusion piece really comes in. We're a very diverse country. We have multiple languages. The connectivity is different for people. There are varied level of affluence, literacy, which we have to deal with. And how do we cater to these needs of the diverse population that we have to ensure the internet is not only accessible, but it's helpful, meaningful, and they can gain from it. And, you know, from the crux of it really is where Internet Sathi came up. Because back then, and like you mentioned, we started this in 2015. When we looked at rural India back then, only 10% of internet users were women. 90% of internet users in rural India were men. And that is possibly the largest online gender divide anywhere, right?
What does the number look like right now?
So now it's improved, you know, thankfully it's improved, and estimates state anywhere between 30 to 40% of internet users are women now. We've come a long way, but, you know, we still do have a very long way to go. And considering the fact that half of the population is women, you know, there's this entire section of population progressing using the internet with women getting left, and I think that definitely needs to be corrected, and we're committed to doing that.
Okay. Let me also highlight the fact that, you know, I think it's safe to say that we've seen many, many years worth of transformation just in the past few months during the COVID-19 pandemic. I would love to get a sense of what organizations such as MyGov, NASSCOM, and of course the Internet Sathi program, what kind of trends did you see during the lockdown? Something that really stood out. Abhishek, let's start with you.
The lockdown was a great opportunity to see what digital technologies can enable. Immediately during lockdown, what happened was that we got a huge responsibility of communications, managing COVID-19 communications. And to do that with remote teams working from all over the NCR, like some of the guys were at Palwal, some were Faridabad, some Ghaziabad, Rohini, all over the spread out. But we quickly adapted to all the tools available, whether VC tools, VPN tools, email tools, GitHub. So, and we ensured the work did not stop. And now when we are like coming out of lockdown, I am finding that my productivity, my team's productivity has gone up much more than what it used to be earlier.
Okay. One thing that you said, the fact that you're wondering whether you do need people back in offices at some point or not, and that's a question that many, many organizations have been asking, and that brings me to the point that Sangeeta highlighted, the fact that this could actually be a digital bridge. Sangeeta, do you think that this is going to open up more job opportunities for folks who did not have physical access to come and be present in certain companies or offices? And maybe this could help us bridge that gap in some way. What are some of the studies that NASSCOM has probably done or seen or observed? If you can highlight some trends for us when it comes to that, as to how we can make this more inclusive?
Definitely, Megha. I think, you know, the transition was sudden. So suddenly from an IT industry perspective, we have some 4 million people working from home. And I think as companies are looking forward, it's no more just about working from home. It's about working from hometowns. So, you know, I don't have to sit in Delhi and work. If I have a place in a remote area and my hometown is there, I can go and work from there. I think the next phase of this new work models that NASSCOM is really looking at is how do you enable the workforce to be present across the hinterland of the country, wherever your hometown is, where your preferences to stay would be, and how can you connect to the job opportunities that would earlier have existed only in the large metro cities. It also opens up to the point on opportunities for women, because clearly in the past it was very hard for women who, well, you know, had family obligations and others to manage the commutes to the workplace or to, you know, travel, etc. I think the whole digital technology shifts that have taken place with this COVID pandemic will now enable many, many more women to be available to work. I think the third is the work models are changing. So it's no more I have to only a 10-hour, 8-hour work shift. Companies are flexible in saying, okay, you have some specific skills, you can work 4 hours a day. So I think the combination of flexibility, location will enable the industry to actually tap a much more diverse work pool and bring in talent from Bharat that we could not leverage earlier because they were not mobile.
Okay. Neha, how do you look at this opportunity when it comes to, you know, several things that Sangeeta said, bringing in talent from Bharat, looking at women into roles that you probably previously could not have looked at? But before I, you know, ask you to address that, I also want to understand out of sheer curiosity, everything that we spoke about our problems during the pandemic, I'm sure they were very different for the kind of users that you deal with as part of the Internet Therapy program. So talk to us about what some of the biggest challenges were that these women in rural parts of the country were facing, especially during the first phases of lockdown, and if their digital skills or knowledge helped them overcome it in whatever little way it did.
Yeah, Sumina, absolutely, right? Like the challenges faced by these women were very different from what we were facing in the cities. I mean, with Internet Sathi, we have over 80,000 Internet Sathis. Internet Sathis are who we call Internet trainers from within villages who help other women get online. And we've covered like close to over 290,000 villages through the program. And, you know, they train, like their reaches, they have actually benefited over 30 million women by helping them get started with their online journey. So what that did is, you know, it eventually connected these women from rural India to the information which was available to everyone. And it gave us a good way to get, I think what was important for them at that point of time was pretty much to get relevant, authoritative, accurate information which they could use. That was one, and we did partner with MyGov, and you know, a lot of our content with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, we took the relevant content, we disseminated it to the Internet Sathis and across over 50,000 villages. And then these companies further disseminated it into the community. So, you know, that itself became a very massive bridge, which Sangeeta was talking about, bridging the information gap for these women and their communities in rural India. And the second thing, which was very interesting, and, you know, we found this even when we introduced the internet to these women, is it opens up a world of opportunities for them, you know. And we saw a lot of these women stitch in their households.
Yeah.
These women started stitching masks. So, for instance, you know, Geeta Sahu in Madhya Pradesh, she's from a small village in Madhya Pradesh. Every day she would get information, she would disseminate it to her village, she would stitch masks and provide it to her village and her communities. So they really, one, they treaded with caution, they wanted the right information which they got, and third, they wanted to continue to go, right? They wanted to continue moving, like they were hit financially as much as anyone else, probably more, and they were finding ways and means of continuing. And the interesting thing is, I think that internet helped bridge that gap and gave them opportunities which they could take up and leverage and keep moving forward.
Okay, you highlighted an excellent point, and Ian spoke about collaboration with MyGov, which is a great segue for my next question, but also the fact that we are now moving from recovery to response, and we're looking at things that we can do on ground, focus on even economic recovery at this point. And for that, and for internet to be more inclusive at that point, we will have to look at more collaborations between private and public sector. So Abhishek, any examples? Of course, Neha just mentioned the fact that she's partnered, Internet Saathi has partnered with MyGov. Any other examples of other private organizations who would have probably partnered with your organization?
In fact, if you look at the last 4 months, two things stand out, which really help us. One is innovation and one is collaboration. And if you look at the major initiatives in the last few months that we have done, whether it's the Arogya Setu app, which was a classic collaborative effort between government, industry, startups, academia, and because of which the world-class app with more downloads than all other contact tracing apps combined world over was developed in 15 days flat. If you look at the other collaborations, we work very closely with Google in ensuring that the shelter homes and the testing centers and all spring up on Google Maps. We work very closely with WhatsApp to set up a chatbot. We work very closely with Facebook to set up a Corona hub for information. And we have worked with almost every private sector entity in partnership with NASSCOM, in partnership with tech companies to ensure that the right information reaches everyone. Behavioral change is driven with the help of everyone. And till a vaccine is found, the solution to these will remain with these only. So collaboration with private sector is part and parcel of the way we function, and it will remain in the days to come. So that we value. Yeah.
Absolutely. I think one thing that was, had a lot of spotlight on, especially during this pandemic, was the fact that there is a genuine skills gap. Even the example that Neha claimed or spoke about, this woman who started her own business and started making masks. Neha, let me ask you, at what point do you think, and I know we are very, very early in the game, but at what point do you think can we elevate those skills from bettering their traditional skills that they already have and elevate it to something that is a skill that they or in someone in their family had never got or aspired to, or they start seeing themselves in roles, in tech roles, as Sangeeta pointed out some time back, that people start seeing women in roles that we wouldn't have imagined them to do or aspire to even get there. When do we start seeing that elevation?
You know, it's already started happening. I think the heartening thing is it's happening. And again, I'm going to go back to our experiences with Internet Saathi. Let me give you one story of Anjali. So Anjali is from a very small village in Maharashtra, Ozarde. She had she didn't get education while she was growing up. She got married into a family, was always doing household work. She joined the Internet Saathi program. And when she joined the program, they were going through some financial issues, and she knew how to make spices. That was her talent. She would make some spices, put them together. She actually used the internet to make that spice making talent into a business. What she did is she learned how to package. She learned how to do branding. She learned how to find the right products and procurement. And she started making from basic masalas to pav bhaji masala, sambar masala. Today, Anjali has gotten 7 other people from her village. She runs a company called Sanskriti Masale. They have won prizes for branding. They have a website of their own, and they supply to the entire country. Now, this is just one of the many stories of women who have found opportunities, if given the opportunity, through the information they find online, tapped into their latent talent, and progressed forward. And we've seen these stories in every villages which we've sort of gone to with Internet Saathi. And this is the power of the internet. It is bridging barriers of whether it's literacy, it's becoming the alternative to the education they didn't have. It's helping that mother teach her child, because earlier she didn't know how to do that. And I think that's really what Sangeeta was talking about. The technology will create the level playing field and open up a world of opportunities for women to progress forward. And through this online progression, we will also see an offline progression of gender equity accelerating much more as we move forward. But we do have to continue to focus to ensure that we're not leaving women out in our digital journey, and that digital inclusive lens for these women continues in every product, every program that we create.
Well, thank you so much for highlighting that story. And I think that's the power of storytelling, where you not only do things right, but also find a time and place to communicate that. I think that really boosts the enthusiasm and the energy of the entire ecosystem. And this is as Atmanirbhar as it gets. And I'm sure that this word is going to excite Abhishek a lot. Abhishek, you guys recently started a challenge and are trying to enable more homegrown companies that are tech-led. Talk to us about the program. And I know we caught you just minutes before you just made the announcement, and right after that you joined us. Talk to us about this challenge that you guys had set up.
Yeah, in fact, the Atmanirbhar Bharat app challenge was launched with the firm belief that we have tech entrepreneurs, we have our startups who have within them to build solutions that will, that can not only be India's best, but they can be world's best. And there were many such apps which required support and recognition. So based on the scenario that was emerging, when there was a there was some apps which were blocked and there was a demand of Indian apps, and there were companies who were building it. So we, the Government of India, launched an honorable Prime Minister announced on the 4th of July for Atmanirbhar Bharat App Innovation Challenge. We got more than 6,940 entries into that. And over the last few weeks, extensive screening, examinations, and jury evaluations were done. We had extensive jury which were comprised of best of people from industry, from startups, from academia, along with a few people from the government. They evaluated it. And today we have declared the results of the App Innovation Challenge. 24 apps have been recognized in the various 9 categories. 20 other apps have been given special mentions, and all these apps are real world-class apps. And they are for people to use, and they are people for to download and make the most out of it. Yeah.
Thank you for highlighting that, and I think for people who are tuned in, that's the beauty of our country. We just spoke about a woman in a rural area who is learning about branding, who's learning about packaging, and learning how she can use her existing traditional skills to set up a startup or set up her own business. And within a few minutes, we started talking about homegrown companies that are looking to make in India but go global. And that is the beauty of the range of startups and skills and the demographic that we have right now. Sangeeta, before I wrap up, let me also ask you about the fact that the current pace of tech innovation that we are seeing, is that enough to fuel economic recovery, or do we need to do something more?
I think we're very impressed with the challenge that Abhishek spoke, right, about that the range of applications, the kind of products, I think the innovativeness that people showed. So I think there is a huge latent innovation potential that India has. I think what the Atmanirbhar talent and programs like this is throwing up the opportunity to make it real, because what we lacked in the past was a market in India, and most, you know, smaller, younger startups would always look for global markets to go out and sell to, and many did not succeed there. I think the current environment is opening up an opportunity where we can build for India, scale in India, and then go global. So I would think it's a good starting point. We have a long way to go. But I would say that, you know, I'm very, very impressed with what we are seeing around us.
Any common synergies that the three of you have managed to find? I know Internet Saathi program has already collaborated with MyGov. But since you guys were on the same platform, listening to each other, any new ideas that probably brewed up during this conversation, and you think that we can look at a deeper collaboration, because that is going to be the need of the hour. And let me give you a quick 30 seconds, starting with Neha, to talk about what else can be done to kind of deepen that partnership between private and public.
So, you know, I'd say, Megha, and we were talking about COVID, and, you know, as we are moving forward, we're all adapting to a new way of functioning, right? And one of the largest segments which has gotten impacted due to COVID right now is the students. There are about 320 million students out there who've gotten impacted by school closures. And we need to ensure that their learning continues. We need to ensure that we bridge the gaps in learning. Now, this requires a concerted effort. This requires partnership between the government, the private sector, everyone coming together to address it. You know, very recently, we've announced a partnership with CBSC, with the Maharashtra government as of yesterday, to train teachers, right? There is a dearth of digital content which is available in Indian languages. I mean, this is one of the largest sections of the population that we're talking about today. It's the future of our country, of our economy. And I think it would be wonderful if we have more collaborations in this space to really improve the quality of education, to improve the quality of content online, and to build capacity for teachers through the tools that we have available to bridge the distance learning gap. So we're committed to it. Like I mentioned, I think we just partnered with CBSE to train 1 million teachers. We've been, through our Google.org efforts, we have funded various organizations. Up to $12 million have gone in digitizing content. But it's still the beginning, and we need to continue to work in this direction. And, you know, inclusion takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of patience. It has to be a persistent effort. And, you know, like they say, if you don't intentionally include, you will by default exclude. So that inclusion lens, it just has to be something which everyone continues to do very proactively.
Absolutely. Sangeeta, your thoughts. What is NASSCOM going to be doing going forward, apart from whatever work you have already done? And as Neha said, is inclusion constantly something that you are thinking about?
Definitely. I think Build for Bharat is a key theme for NASSCOM. And I think what we are looking at is more sectoral focus. What can we do in the space of agriculture? What can we do in healthcare? I think skilling is definitely a very high priority area. And our focus would be to collaborate with companies like Google, MyGov. Already we partner with on a lot of different initiatives, and you know, we would only look to further strengthen that partnership, but also build partnerships with the NGOs and other partners on the ground, because to do inclusion, you still need the footprint on the ground to make things happen. So our effort would be to build as many more collaborations and partnerships that we can to make much of this more real for India.
Okay, so the private has spoken. What does the public have to say? Abhishek, your thoughts on how you can foster further collaboration, and what would be the need of the hour, say, in the next few months that's left of 2020, and how can we make the most of it?
I fully endorse the views expressed by Neha and Sangeeta ji, and we have to strengthen the bonds which are already built, whether it's working with NASSCOM for prime skills or whether it's working with NASSCOM for emerging technologies. We are working very closely with them on the AI portal. And then we also have partnerships with Google going on various stuff with regard to Google's accelerator program. We work closely with ensuring that Indian apps go on Android Play Store and ensure that people learn from the best practices. So there is enough scope for innovating, collaborating. The foundations are laid. We need to strengthen them and go further on that.
Well, thank you so much, Abhishek, Neha and Sangeeta, for sharing those thoughts. And I think it's safe for us to say that we will have to reimagine a new world order to rebound from this pandemic and bridge that gap that we spoke about when it comes to India and Bharat. And hopefully tech is what will take us through. Thank you so much for joining us on this panel. Our job here is to just enable and at least start some of these conversations. And I think we've managed to do that in whatever little time that we had. But for all the viewers who are tuned in, thanks a lot for watching it.
Indeed, it is, Megha, brave new world. And as we heard in that discussion, scores of success stories coming out. And what's especially a meaningful line in that discussion was that access is great, but it's the products and services catering to the citizens that give it that meaning. Well, a whole host of technologies spanning AI to blockchain and cloud computing to data analytics are providing the necessary answers to many of today's and tomorrow's problems. So in this concluding session with leaders of industry, we are going to look at how those solutions are transforming the way we live, the way we learn, and the way we earn. And sharing with us these lessons in excellence are Padmaja Ruparel from the India Angel Network and IAN Fund, Varun Dua from Acko General Insurance, Vamshi Krishna from Vedantu, Renuka Ramnath from IVCA, Vasudevan Chinnathambi from NinjaCart, and Karthik Padmanabhan from Google India. And shepherding this PAR group session titled Solving for India is Shruti Mishra from CNBC TV 18.
CNBC TV 18 and Google presents Digital India Vision 5.0.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our panel, Solving for India at the Digital India Vision 5.0 Virtual Summit. The onset of the pandemic has fast-tracked digital adoption, leading to several landmark solutions in the area of education, health and society. now to take us through some of these solutions and how technology can solve some of India's biggest challenges. Joining me now are Parmadal Ruparel, co-founder of Indian Angel Network, Varun Dua, MD and CEO of ACCO, Vamsi Krishna, co-founder and CEO of Vedantu, Renuka Ramnath, founder, MD and CEO, Multiples Alternate Asset Management, and chairperson, IFTA. Vasudevan Chinnathambi, co-founder Ninja Card, and Karthik Padmanabhan, developer relations lead at Google India. Now, welcome panelists. Let me start with you, Renuka. The government is bullish on emerging technologies like artificial intelligence, cloud computing, blockchain, and data analytics. What to your mind are the top technological changes that will allow the kind of growth India really needs, and in what segments? Also, how do you see these technologies help in job creation?
Well, I think, as all of us know, Shruti, technology is going to cut across all sectors. The early adoption and big disruptions have been seen in education, healthcare, financial services, but we see that in telecom, we see that in literally every industry. So today, I can't think of an industry which will not have either a big opportunity or a big threat from technology. Of course, things like artificial intelligence, machine learning are helping solve problems for short supply. So for instance, I have an investment in an AIML company called Quantify. And during this pandemic, we have really grown in our business in the health tech area, where you have to solve for testing, let us say, for a number of patients, or reading reports for mega data in a very, very short span of time. So while that is there at the leading edge of technology, but I think the fact that technology A makes businesses operationally at a lower cost, connects the suppliers and customers in a platform with ease, and now with the availability of gadgets and ability to operate on lower bandwidth, it just democratizes availability of goods and services. So I think it is going to impact all the sectors.
Okay, but Renuka, what are the key policy and regulatory changes that need to happen to ensure job creation? Because that's a big challenge that India currently is facing. What should the first wave be?
Well, I would not bother too much about policy changes, except that I would say that just we need to provide more capital to entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
And, the recent announcement yesterday that banks can lend to venture and that will be qualified as a, priority sector is also a very, very interesting big step in that, in that direction. I think that what technology is doing, Shruti, really is, instead of thinking about job creators and job seekers as somebody who are going to be married for 10 hours day after day and for a lifetime, technology is really allowing people to discover themselves and engage in giving themselves a job or a vocation at their discretion. You know, today when you look at Vamsi is the best person to talk about it. On his online education, I'm sure there are people who come in for just 4 hours. There will be people who will come in only on the weekends. What technology is really doing is to expand the supply of, talent into the market and thereby contributing to the growth. And our job is really to provide capital and give them the right guidance so that we don't fritter away capital. I think that is very, very important that we are a capital-starved economy and we need to provide that guidance.
Of course, Renuka, what you're talking, we'll also be discussing in the later part of the show, about opening domestic funding. But Vamsi, let me come to you right now. Online learning adoption in India is at an all-time high. Vedantu recorded a growth of 220% during lockdown, with more than 2 million students attending, live classes. So the blackboard education system has been replaced with the online education system, giving more flexibility to teachers and to students. Vamsi, how do you see technology solving some of the big challenges the sector faces, especially in ensuring quality education for all.
Thanks for having me here, Shruti. And in fact, just resonating what Renuka just said, there is no sector, I would say, education is definitely the one.
Yeah.
Right now, going through a lot of changes. And rightly so, because traditional forms of teaching and learning, especially the schools and, you know, also other forms of tutoring and the coaching, destinations because of the pandemic has shut down. So that has allowed this sector to probably take a leapfrog jump, which normally would have happened, I would say like in 3 years, is now happening in, let's say, 3 months or 4 months. So that's the fundamental shift. But as she was saying, that there is no sector, I think, which is not affected positively or negatively. I'm a big believer that education fundamentally, especially for a country like India, where we do have so many strata of children at different price point to serve, technology is the ultimate enabler. Unlike an offline, here you're not really restricted to a teacher who needs to be available around your geography. So that technology has an ability to make a teacher anywhere available to a student from any part of the country. And I think especially a country like India needs solutions like this. And only then can we solve such big problems at scale.
Yeah. Kartik, let me come to you. Now, there is a huge population that are first-time users of the internet. We have in India and then there is Bharat. How does one ensure that education is inclusive for all? Google has the means and the infrastructure. How does Google plan to reach to the hinterland and make quality education for all a reality?
Thank you for the question, Shruti. And I really want to thank you all for having us here on this panel. So it's an interesting place we are in right now. So we've been solving for Bharat for last 2 years through the Google for Startups Accelerator. And through this accelerator, we have reached through a partnership model to tier two cities and tier three towns. And we see a lot of exciting prospects of startups thinking about local problems and trying to solve them. And education, healthcare, logistics, and agri-tech are something which we see as an area where there's a lot of action and a lot of interest from startups to solve this locally. And once they're able to solve this locally, it's obviously they'll be able to scale it, right? So if it's relevant for a certain part of the region in India, it's definitely relevant for large part of India. So we see increasingly a great pipeline of quality startups now thinking of solving India problems at scale. And in the recent past, what we have seen is edutech has been obviously, for obvious reasons, people have been scrambling around, and we're starting to receive a lot of great applications for that in the recent batch of the Google for Startups Accelerator.
Yeah. Okay. So the boundaries of the classroom are definitely going beyond expectation and more. And also an area where technology can play a huge role is reskilling and upskilling. Padmaja, let me come to you. We are in the middle of the largest global labor market shift in over a century as millions of displaced workers look to make the difficult transition into new in-demand careers. How can technology help in reskilling and upskilling people and help them navigate today's new economic reality?
Thanks, Shruti. First of all, thank you for having me on the show. I think, this is not just upskilling and retraining, and it's not just an edutech opportunity.
Okay.
I think the reality is that all of us, and then every strata we have to pivot ourselves in our skills, in our thinking, and how we operate. So we are a little fortunate that we have been able to move towards digitization faster, purely because of who we are. But remember, a large part of India has to move there. And what demonetization in about 4 years ago could not achieve, COVID has. That's the positive, that it has brought people onto the digital platform and made them complete. Digital is becoming a demand. It's not a push now. It's a pull.
Absolutely.
So that's one. Secondly, India is not just the cities. I think what you mentioned a little earlier, it's Bharat, and India is, and Bharat even more, is a very, very diverse set of people across the country, whether north, south, east, west, very different consumer behaviors, very different demands, very different needs. And that's a huge opportunity for training people, for upskilling them, for bringing technology in their lives, in their everyday lives. And therefore, they need that adaptation ability to adopt those technologies. I mean, just think of it, that people are now digitally, they're doing digital banking. Those who were earlier interacting with currency, you know, cash, now they've moved to digital banking, which means then they not only need to know technology, they need to know it in their language, in their vernacular. And that we've invested in a company which is called Vernacular, doing exactly this, enabling this. That's the second big piece. The third piece is, you know, India is a huge opportunity, and I personally feel it is the world's pilot platform. If something works in India somewhere, right, in our 29 states with such diverse consumer behavior, customer behavior, markets are so different, you know, completely different. I mean, what the North wants, the South is probably doesn't even think about it, right? I think if we can make something work in India, it will work somewhere else in the world for sure. So we are actually sitting in a place where we are being going to be able to not only pivot, pilot, create products, create people, behavior change, but we will also be able to propel it to different parts of the world. And that's the opportunity I think we are sitting on today.
Absolutely. And, you know, continuing with what Padmaja said earlier, Vamsi, you know, the education sector is facing a tectonic shift as enterprises seek more and better talent with digital skill sets. The technology training market is set to explode. What are you seeing here?
See, I think clearly, we are seeing strong tailwinds, you know, as some of the panelists also mentioned. What we're also seeing is technology is fundamentally allowing disruption at scale. So for example, the ability in an offline setup wherein one teacher can only take a handful of students, like say in technology, it's in online, every child is a friend bencher, right? You're really not, you know, in a physical classroom where you really feel that sense of sitting in a big classroom. So what that fundamentally enables us to do from a technology standpoint of view is create a product which can, let's say, expand that one teacher to not just, let's say, 5 students or 50 students, but let's say 500 students, not compromise on experience. And what that does at a very basic level is disrupt the price point. And when you disrupt the price point, suddenly that same quality teaching is able to go to the masses, to the Bharat, as you know, you're mentioning. And these are some of the fundamental shifts which is impossible to happen in an offline setup. And yes, in technology-enabled teaching and learning, these things are real possibility, and it will essentially benefit the parents and the students, right?
At the end of the day. Okay, Vamsi. Now, from edtech, let's now move to agritech. Vasudevan, you're making life easy for farmers who had no access to organized trade, helping them get the right price for their produce. NinjaCart has leveraged technology to build a cost-effective supply chain, and I believe it delivers produce directly from the farm to store on a daily basis. Vasudevan, tell me, how are you at NinjaCart solving the challenges of demand-supply mismatch, unfair market practices, you know, high quantum of food wastage, and low income for farmers through technology?
Yeah. Thank you, Sudhir, for having NinjaCart on the panel. So I think demand-supply asymmetry is one of the very strong problems, right? Like very structural problem for Indian agriculture, especially for fruits and vegetable farmers. The problem is no one can sort of predict how much of tomato will arrive in a city market tomorrow morning. And this sort of becomes the entire thing as a gamble, right? I mean, farmers to harvest the produce, bring the product there, and then sort of figure out what's the price and what's the demand like. And this has traditionally sort of put the farmer at the very high risk position, and then like, you know, it's always a gamble for him, right? So what we're trying to do structurally is change this completely and sort of put a lot more power in the farmer's hand. So one thing that we do is we start recommending farmers in terms of what crops to grow and when to grow. And we do this by, we have last 5 years of data in terms of supply, demand, pricing, etc. So we sort of use these data points to sort of develop a model and sort of recommend them what crops to do it. That's sort of very useful for them, one. Two, we are the only platform where we communicate the exact demand and the price even before the harvesting starts, right? Contrary to the traditional markets. So what this happens is like the farmer is, it's a lot more democratic process, right? Like farmer can choose to not harvest the produce if the price is not good or the demand is not viable for him. So that's the second point that, the change that we're going into this whole thing. The third is, in terms of the payments, where we sort of do a direct transfer to the bank accounts in 24 hours, that sort of puts in a lot more power for them. Whereas in the traditional markets, it sort of takes a lot more time for them to realize the income in the NAN. And third, of course, we sort of try and cut down his cost in terms of logistics, etc., by opening up collection centers, which is closer to the farm than where he has to travel like 100, 150 kilometers to sort of sell his produce. These are the four areas where we are making very structural changes, which would farmer income and then change the certainty of his business.
Okay, Vasudevan, there's a follow-up question. You know, there is an increase in consumer awareness with regards to what we eat, and people want to know from where their fruits, vegetables have been sourced from. So how are you making traceability data available? That's a big thing now.
Yeah. So I think safe food for, billion people is one of the strong visions, right? Like, I mean, this is something that we want to sort of make it possible, if not today, at least in 10 years from now. So in that, 100% traceability becomes a very core part of it. And interestingly, today our current supply chain is already, it has 100% footprint, where if you pick up a tomato from a store that is supplied by NinjaCart, I could sort of tell you what is the origin in terms of the farmer details, etc. Also the entire supply chain footprint, right? So what's missing is the farm footprint, where in terms of knowing what it went into production, what sort of fertilizers got used, and etc.
Yeah.
Which is where we are currently working on with the farmers to sort of understand the complete farm footprint. And of course, at the customer end, we need to sort of create a lot more awareness in terms of the benefits of the traceability, and then sort of how it sort of increases the entire food safety. And this is one of the very core area where NinjaCart is sort of investing heavily now, and it will continue to invest, I think, huge part in the coming years.
All right, we'll keep a watch on that. But let's now shift gears and focus on the insurance sector. Varun, you call yourselves a tech-first insurance company, and insurance penetration is very low in India, and the country needs solutions to mitigate this challenge. ACCO is a pure-play, digital-only, non-life insurance player. How does your model help fast-track insurance penetration?
Thanks, Shruti. Thank you for having us over. You're right that we're sort of a completely digital insurer. If you look at insurance penetration, it's traditionally been pretty weak in India, and maybe the top 50 to 100 million people have some sort of insurance, and then there is this new schemes that have come up in the government, things like Ayushman Bharat, covering probably the bottom 500 million people, but there's still this huge gap of another 600 million people who don't have insurance, are also not covered by the government in any sense. And when you look at, and the problem that there is one, of course, there's an awareness problem. And beyond that point, there's an affordability and distribution problem. Because the sizes at which, these people can be insured, the awareness levels, the education required and the reach required, it's the economics don't work out. And that's been, probably one of the reasons why traditional insurance has not yet reached the hinterland, or not yet reached the 600-700 million people that it's supposed to. I think one of the things, I don't think in insurance it's possible for one company to do it. There are infrastructural challenges to be solved. So for example, technology today is allowing us to create products which are, maybe you could pay daily, a small sum daily. It needs to be bundled in into telecom infrastructure is now open to a level where the government and the insurance companies and TRAI are probably working together. Then how do you use this huge mobile penetration to actually activate insurance, right? Because that's one reach mechanism. So you will first have to figure out the reach mechanism, which of course is today technology. You cannot reach 600-700 million people physically in any shape or form and enroll them into some sort of security coverage. And for that to happen, manufacturers like ACCO need to come up with products and payment propositions and delivery channels, and probably the infrastructure of a WhatsApp and SBI and a Google and telecom needs to come together to solve this problem.
Okay.
There's no one point solution, but I think what technology can deliver is the product construct, the pricing ability, and have digital channels reach this swath of customers. That's the only way to do it. There's no other way in India, but 600 million people.
Also, Varun, the COVID experience has demonstrated the need for mass affordable health insurance. India needs fresh ideas on the table for this challenge, given that individual medical expenditure is essentially out of pocket. Does ACCU have something unique to offer in this space?
So I think one of the things, like on the panel we heard that how demonetization and COVID, these are sort of game changing. Yeah. I think COVID has been a game changing moment for health insurance awareness in the country. I don't think any amount of advertising by the government or the industry or education would have created the amount of awareness that COVID has, you know, sort of ended up creating. At ACCU, we've seen, you know, customers thronging our website, asking for corona insurance products, regular health insurance products. 25-year-olds who would probably not even think of buying, you know, insurance probably for the next 10 years in their life, this suddenly is mass awareness. Like I mentioned, you know, from an ACCU perspective, I think one of the things that we're trying to do is figure out products for every segment. The government has launched, another product with the help of the regulator called Arogya Sanjeevani, which one of the biggest challenges in choosing health insurance, and I point to health insurance specifically because that's sort of the need of the hour, is it's very difficult for people to decipher what to buy. It's just pretty complex. There are just the number of plans that are there. And what's covered, what's not covered. So the government has worked together with the regulator to come up with a product called, you know, Arogya Sanjeevani, which is standardizes every feature, and you can just blindly, you know, go and buy. So what ACCU is doing is that it's keeping the prices of these products really low for people and finding very scalable digital distribution channels. Google could distribute, WhatsApp could distribute, Amazon we partner with, they could distribute. Telecom infrastructure could, distribute these products. Because the decision-making load is off the customer. He's being given a product by the consumer, and it's our job to use technology and deliver these products. So that's we're looking at it.
All right. Now, so COVID has clearly been a game changer, and Padmaja, coming back to you, there's a lot of talk on being Atmanirbhar, but is enough being done to make Indian startups Atmanirbhar?
It's a very interesting question. I think you're right. There's a lot of talk of being Atmanirbhar. There's a lot of opportunity for us to become Atmanirbhar. But there are two pieces. I think there is a lot more that we need to do. See, the world has gone through a global recession. There is a liquidity crunch around the world. Okay. And while we are, especially in investing in startups and growing them, we have been largely reliant on money coming in from overseas. That is going to slow down. It has, for that matter. Okay. So there is clearly a need for domestic capital to open up. We must open up our private institutional money and government money, for that matter, to actually invest in these startups, which is not only going to be for startups, for just the startup industry, but they are innovating and taking our entire larger industry, traditional industries, to the next level, because we are all going through a new normal.
Absolutely.
So, you know, technology enablement is a very wide word. So I'm using it in that wide meaning. There is a huge need to change things, and it is happening, and it is being demanded.
You know, you mentioned very clearly, and sorry I'm cutting you in, but the, like Renupa also mentioned earlier, that the RBI has put startups in the priority lending sector. Now, this surely will open credit for the sector. But what you're saying, that, you know, there is an anti-China sentiment. So if you don't want money from China, who fills the gap? You know, Padmaja, how can we increase domestic funding? How do we encourage private money to open up then?
Yes, so we have to have enabling mechanisms so that domestic investors can invest. So starting right from the angels, right, who are taking a very early risk when they invest in the startup level, we have to make it enabling for them. We have to make sure that they invest there. We are currently paying more tax on cap gains in the startup and unlisted space than we are doing for publicly listed companies, right? Yeah. Whereas the risk levels at a startup level are much higher. So the risk reward needs to be aligned. Just as an example, right? There's so much institutional money, be it insurance companies, etc. There are laws like the IRDA law that needs to be amended. So we need to pick the enabling, what we can do to make it more enabling and make those changes. Clearly that is required. Otherwise, we're not going to be able to build in the domestic market, kid. And
the reality is we are a sixth of the world's population. Look, we have a market size of our own, right? Even before we can go to the world. I mean, you've been talking to Vamsi, you've been talking about agriculture. This country in itself, on its own, can make so much of job creation, wealth, value, and so many changes. But it has to open up. There has to be. The second big piece which is going to come, and I hate to be saying this, but with the COVID, the moratoriums are going to end now. Okay, all the moratoriums that were announced, they have to end. They can't continue forever. If not, you know, even if it gets extended from August to September, the reality is it will have to end. And we'll see failures. And startups are going to fail much faster than any other category of companies. And what we need, therefore, is an ability for these startup and founders to actually quickly wind up and pick up their lives and get going. And the last piece is, why are we talking about Atmanirbhar alone? We have the ability to be Atmanirbhar and make Dunya Nirbhar on India. Why don't we put that on the table and start building for the world? We have nothing lacking. We have talent, we have market, we have skills, we have consumers, we have the ability to do whatever we want. Hey guys, all the entrepreneurs on this show, please start thinking. Duniya ko nirbhar karo apne aap pe.
Very, very well put, Padmaja. And you know, my follow-up question is that, you know, startups are agile. They have been innovating the fastest in this pandemic. And you know, they have their limitations, like you mentioned. You've helped businesses grow. What are the changes that need to be made to really empower them today?
I think, first of all, doing business in India, we've moved many, many points and we've improved. But, you know, we have to now focus on clearly winding up businesses. There's going to be complete disarray there, number one. Yeah. Number two, how do we unlock monies? The RBI ruling for priority sectors, excellent. I have a little bit more white hair than people around. I'm saying the devil is in the detail. Will it get done? What's going to stop? And that's where I think we need to focus. Get the processes cleaned up. You know, these are not, it's not enough to have headlines. Number three, how do we unleash domestic money, be it private, be it institutional, change IRDA laws, make it easier for people to write checks in startups and get the economy churning rather than buy some dead asset out there. Number four, we have founders, we have talent that's going to come across. How do we bring them into the system? I mean, there's so many things that need to be cleared out.
Absolutely. Karthik, you know, coming quickly to you, Niti Aayog says that with Atal Innovation Mission, it has laid the foundation of a thriving ecosystem of mentors and industry partners, startups, incubators. Do you see this collaborative efforts truly helping solve for India? And what are the key sectors that should see short to medium term solutions?
So we are very excited with the prospects. And after going through the report, we feel there's a huge opportunity for us to solve in a way that we are able to apply AI for social good. And we feel that three sectors are very, very lucrative. One is education, second is healthcare, and third is agriculture. And these sectors are the ones where we can apply AI and machine learning to solve problems at scale. And this has to be worked in a way that we are able to work with the industry, we are able to work with the research, and then of course Google can bring in this open source platform to through an acceleration model so that we are able to solve these, help these institutions as well as startups scale these problems at scale. So I don't see this as a problem which can be solved by a institution. It has to be a collaborative effort where it has to play a role of making sure that the data sets are available. Startups have to be making sure that they work with academia and research institutions. Companies like Google should be able to make sure that we are able to provide the platform and mentorship so that all these pieces get together, and then we are able to focus on some real world problems in education or healthcare and agri-tech and solve that escape. And so looking at how do we apply AI for good in this particular area.
All right. Vasudevan, coming to you, and you know, let's talk about the kind of social impact startups can bring about. How do we make it inclusive? We also need to support the cause of women and children who are part of the unorganized sector. You know, you're working with farmers in the unorganized sector. What is the kind of social impact technology really needs to bring about and startups need to focus on?
Yeah. So I think at a very foundation level, I think it is going to create a very strong information infrastructure, I think, which alone will be a big enabler in a lot of ways, right? If you look at farmers today, I think the strong mobile penetration, I think now all the farmers have access to the market prices in terms of what the market demand like and market supply side, one. Two, in terms of on the farm input side, I mean, they're able to sort of browse through different farm inputs available, right, and share across in WhatsApp groups among the farmers. So the information infrastructure alone would be, I think, bigger enabler in a lot of some of these sectors, right? Like especially in the agricultural sector that where we witness very closely. Second, I think the entire the capital and like, you know, the seamless payments and then etc. alone also will sort of make things a lot more robust in terms of, it'll build a very strong trust ecosystem. It'll sort of help people access capital much more faster. And which alone again will you know, increase the output of the entire sector. Right? So I think these are two core areas where I think some structural change will come from. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you know, Varun, let me come to you now. You're the voice from the fintech space, essentially. What is the prognosis for early stage startups in a post-COVID world? What is the different kind of support they would require now in this new world?
I think from a, you know, fintech has played out very differently, you know, since the pandemic. We still to have this broad fintech definition. If you're in the digital payments business, you're doing great. You know, everybody wants to pay digitally. If you're in the lending business, and especially if you're a startup which is taking on some risk on your balance sheet, I think you're in trouble for now, for no fault of theirs. But, you know, so I think we in insurance have seen, you know, mixed bag of results. Something like health is taking off. Something like auto insurance had a problem. People were, you know, it's the largest market. Auto insurance, one of the largest markets in non-life. People are not taking their cars out, procrastinating purchases of auto insurance, but health insurance demand is sort of going up. So I think from a fintech perspective, it's not a one-size-fits-all. And I think if you're in any shape and form, whether you're an insurer or you're a lender, if you're a balance sheet player, I think it's very, very tricky times and you need to watch out. I can give, you know, a specific example. Insurers used to, from ACO, insurers have been writing job loss coverage just blindly for the last few decades. And it's a profitable product that if you, you know, and especially, you know, there's a balance sheet drag on job. Nobody ever imagined the number of job losses that this could have. Risk to the balance sheet, I think it's time for startups and fintechs to be careful. To be able to opt for the capital and see that they're adequately covered. But if you're in the intermediation space or the technology enablement space, I think it's a great time to be there because a lot of systemic changes that could not have happened are just leapfrogging at another level. So that's what I would.
Okay, now before I wrap up this session, Vamsi, my question to you. You know, to solve India's challenges, be it social, business or economy, it all boils down to getting quality education. So how do you see technology creating a social impact and ensuring education doesn't stop for any child? Because, you know, because of the COVID and the pandemic, a lot of children are going back to, you know, leaving schools and joining labor and all of that. So how are you ensuring education doesn't stop for any child?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think the answer already lies in the stuff which we see happening nearby us, Shruti. If you imagine the same situation, right, happening 10 years back, yeah, there is no way we could have even imagined, forget about, you know, which class. Across the classes, there would not have been no way in which any form of education would have continued with schools getting shut down and all. But I think it is because of the tech you know, developments over the last decade or so, that we are sitting in now situation where we are having this kind of interactions, right? Sitting from our homes, teaching and learning, knowledge transfer is happening. And I think with the kind of device penetration, internet penetration, it's the entire ecosystem, right? It's not just education companies which needs to do their bit. It's, I think, internet companies, the device manufacturers, all of this comes together creates an ecosystem where the device accessibility, the infrastructure accessibility in terms of internet at a price point which is affordable, and then on top of that, this innovations from education companies and else, others make all of these three things has to come together for so that the learning doesn't stop, and not just the learning, commerce doesn't stop, the economy doesn't stop. And I think we are very lucky to be at least in this place where we are, if not 100% there, we are almost there. I reflect back on this. If it would have been 10 years back, it would have been a very different situation. But yes, as Padmaja was saying, I think this is a unique opportunity for all of us to not just think about India, but even think globally. And a lot of opportunities is going to.
All right. So, I just wanted to add one small comment. You did ask that what do we need to do? Actually, what we need to do has already started. Okay. In the last 3 months of lockdown, think about the geo investment that's happened. Now, one can look at it from an investment perspective, but what has really happened is there is a technology highway that has been created in the country.
Yeah.
Right. And that's an extremely, extremely, I think, seminal step that has happened. And that has created an opportunity not only for startups and companies and everybody to go technology focused, but I think it's a huge opportunity for us to swivel the way we do business, the way we live life, the way we entertain ourselves, the way we do anything. And all I can say is technology disruption is not only what we need to do, but if we don't do it, if we don't pivot, we perish. So it's as seminal, today's session is as seminal as saying pivot or perish.
All right.
That's what it's telling us.
Very well put, Padmaja, pivot or perish. Vamsi says learning should continue, economy should continue. A lot of takeaways from this session. And with that, we've come to the end of this discussion. Panelists, many thanks for joining us today. It was a pleasure speaking to all of you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for inviting me to the CNBC TV 18 Digital India Vision 5.0 Summit. Digital India has attracted the attention of almost everyone, both within the country and abroad. In a large and diverse country like India, it is not only the introduction of new initiatives, but our ability to rapidly execute and to scale up programs to reach out to our 1.3 billion citizens that is central to achieving success. Technology has been the key driver to achieving that. With over 600 million connections, India has become the largest consumer of broadband in the world. 500 million plus Indians are now using smartphones, which means over 77% of Indians are now accessing wireless broadband through smartphones. India has the world's highest data usage per smartphone at an average of 9.8 GB per month, and the number is set to nearly double by 2024. India consumes more data per person than China and Korea. India is digitizing faster than the rest of the world. We know we now need to channelize this strength, clean up and annotate these humongous sources of data, and create structured sets that can power artificial intelligence algorithms that India needs to solve many of the challenges of India in the field of education, health, agriculture. And if we are able to solve our problems, we'll be able to solve the problems of the rest of the world. India is one of the fastest growing economies, and with the second largest population in the world, we have a very significant stake in the AI revolution. It is estimated that the economic opportunity from AI is expected to be in addition of $957 billion by 2035, boosting the GDP by 1.3 percentage points. The Digital India program has witnessed a consistent upward growth trajectory, achieving numerous milestones and flagship initiatives. These achievements cover a wide plethora of sectors and include development of broadband highways, universal access to mobile connectivity, public internet across programs, e-governance, to name just a few. Many major schemes and projects such as Aadhaar, Smart Cities, BHIM, UPI, RuPay, GSTN, Government E-Marketplace, DigiLocker, all come under the aegis of the Digital India program. When I was a young officer, all this was paperwork. Many of our schemes, money used to be transferred from central to state government, states to districts, and districts to panchayat. And one of our prime ministers said that a vast amount of money, almost 85%, was actually leaked and only 15 paisa out of a rupee reached the poor person. All this has radically changed because all our schemes today are sent directly into the bank accounts of persons who are the beneficiaries. And therefore, this has been possible because during 2014 and 18, every second bank account opened in the world was opened in India. We have created biometric for every Indian. Every Indian has a mobile. And therefore, we are throwing up massive amounts of data. Digital India also focuses on tapping into the potential of the digital startup ecosystem, as India is home to over 9,300 tech startups, which make it the third largest tech startup ecosystem in the world. But we have a very vibrant, dynamic ecosystem. A large number of these startups dabble in niche areas in technology like AI, blockchain, analytics, cybersecurity. We have added over 1,300 tech startups just this last year. The growth in the e-commerce market, which is worth 54 billion today, is a testament to the government efforts. The government of India has also collaborated with major technology companies worldwide to realize its vision. Google collaborated with Indian Railways to set up free Wi-Fi services at 100 major railway stations in India. Microsoft has worked with the government of India on the Digital India Initiative, with the most recent contribution being the Digital Governance Tech Tour. We closely partner Google in many of our initiatives. Since its inception, our government has been consistently scaling the Digital India Initiative and has substantially increased outlays for it year after year. In my opinion, digitization has been a prominent theme in this COVID-19 world. India has been taking massive strides in our digital capabilities for the past several years and has thus prepared for the technology disruptions that COVID-19 may have induced. Only companies and countries which are driving digitization will succeed and flourish. And therefore, the country was already on a digital first trajectory, with one of the highest volumes of digital transactions in the world, when the pandemic struck and further propelled the use of contactless digital technology. Since the beginning of its COVID-19 lockdown in last March, India has distributed around 5 billion in cash benefits to its citizens who needed assistance the most, almost entirely through payments made via digital platforms. The digital first mindset of a country of 1.3 billion people is not only a technological advancement, but more importantly, it is the foundation of a new mechanism for the deliverance of goods of governance. Almost every Indian now has the digitally authenticated Aadhaar identification number. The connection of Aadhaar with bank accounts and mobile phones, or what we call the JAM Trinity, is the bedrock of much of the digitization drive. JAM played the role of a safety net, helping millions who needed immediate money aid through ubiquitous direct transfer of state benefits. Aadhaar is also the base for India Stack, a set of open APIs which developers can use as the foundation for their applications. And this is not all. To effectively track and monitor the spread of COVID-19, we created the Arogya Setu app, which has been downloaded more than 140 million times and made it open source. it has emerged as the world's most downloaded COVID-19 contact tracing app. By using technology, the state governments are also managing the demand, availability, and use of equipments like ventilators as well as essential medical equipments, including N95 masks and personal protection equipment. And my view is that Arogya Setu and other allied initiatives like the National E-Health Authority and the new telemedicine guidelines are blending towards a national health step. And therein you would see that India is moving from being a mere software outsourcing destination to being a great product platform first nation. Ladies and gentlemen, today let me take this opportunity to talk about our robustness in terms of security, privacy, data protection, and data ownership of every citizen. Whether it is ensuring net neutrality or schemes and programs aiming to provide internet connection and mobile phones to each and every individual, the focus of next billion users has shifted so firmly and irreversibly to India, and we are all strong in our resolve to keep the internet open and accessible to all. In fact, you will find that India is the world's strongest net neutrality norms anywhere in the world, guaranteeing an open and fair internet for over 500 million active internet users. The Personal Data Protection Bill has been drafted to undertake this mammoth task of protecting the right to privacy of 1.3 billion Indians by regulating approximately 600 million entities. The bill adopts good practices of involvement of various stakeholders such as industry, trade association, departments of the government, and sectoral regulators and the public in the formulation of code of practices. The proposed non-personal data protection framework unlocks the economic value of data and ensures a good data governance and sharing practice. India's internet economy is amongst the most attractive in the world, and it is not just in terms of the sheer magnitude of its base. 500 million smartphone users and the world's second largest internet population. We have chosen not to go down the pathway of a closed internet economy like China, and there's been a recent spate of overseas investment post-COVID in the internet space to the tune of almost $22 billion. India's digitization has had a positive impact on development and growth, providing new opportunities for skilling, jobs and basic services, and this trend will continue. In fact, it will be one of the strongest drivers of India's growth story. India provides a perfect playground for enterprises and institutions globally to develop scalable solutions which can be easily implemented in the rest of the developing and emerging economies. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Thank you.
And with that, it's a wrap for this edition of Digital India Vision 5.0, a virtual summit brought to you by Google and CNBC TV 18. Thank you very much for tuning in.
CNBC TV 18 and Google presents Digital India Vision 5.0.